what's coming. We've seen it before. But this is our home, and we are ready. We've trained to be harder, faster, stronger.
Hello everybody and welcome to the Stoop as Gallagher Premiership Rugby returns, as does Harlequins Live, presented by Silverbug. We're delighted to have you on board wherever you're watching around the world, and we've got a great show for you this evening as well. Plenty of opportunities for you to get involved as supporters watching at home. Of course, you can't be here. It'll be a great welcome back for you when you can, but for now, this is the next best thing. For members, make sure you log into your portal this evening. Use the code QUIN Chiefs 150. That'll give you 150 points to use as you wish, and throughout the season there'll be more opportunities for you as Harlequins Live fans to get more points. The big prize this evening, tonight though, is, yeah, here we go, you can walk away. Well, I say walk away, it'll be posted to you with this, the brand new third kit. I'm sure you've seen the promotional video. In fact, we're going to catch up with Rachel Burford about that. She was on the shoot yesterday. This is the third jersey that's going to be worn this season. The first time it'll be worn is in the Heineken Champions Cup on the 20th of December against Munster. It's made with recycled plastic. You want me to throw this back, but I'm going to keep it a little bit closer for now because it's such a great jersey. It's quite easy to win. We're only going to be giving one away, but tonight we're running the theme of rugby heroes. Who is your rugby hero? If you're watching on Facebook or on YouTube, all you have to do is type it into the chat box. Who is your rugby hero? Doesn't matter if it's someone local, doesn't matter if they still play, doesn't matter if it's one of the lads who's warming up here. Oh, there we go, friend of the show, could be making his debut this evening. Alas, just let us know your rugby hero and you could win this third jersey. I've done about 10 interviews today and you want to hear from all of them. The first was a little walk from the changing room with two of our academy stars, Lewis and Lennox. Sean is on the camera this evening and he got battered and bruised in the making of this. So hopefully you'll spare a little thought for Sean, but you'll enjoy this chat about rugby heroes that I had with Lennox and Lewis. I've been sniffing around the changing room. I've been told to sling my hook, but not without bringing a special guest with me. Friend of the show, Lennox, great to have you back.
Thank you very much.
Talk and walk.
Let's go.
First game of a new season this evening. You're not involved. What does rugby mean for you at the moment? Are you playing? Are you training? Where are you at with it?
I'd say it's a lot of training, a lot of preparing the boys who are involved in matches week in, week out from now on, and also kind of being their fans, essentially. We don't really have fans right now.
Okay.
So bringing the noise, being that voice.
So are you whooping and hollering?
A lot of noise. A lot of let's go, similar to Tex that you'll see later on today. Yeah.
So what's happening here is we're trying to get out. We're going to walk through the tunnel here. But I'm very aware that I'm getting close to Sean, who's on camera. So if I'm walking too quick for you, mate, just give me a nod. Rugby heroes is a big theme today. Who were yours growing up? I say growing up. What are you now? 19.
19. Yeah. Biggest one would be Martin Only for me, the All Black. Yeah. So like growing up watching rugby, he was the first person I kind of noticed. Had very big hair. Liked to wear eyeliner. Really weird. But
just taking a look.
I'm not on today. But yeah, and it was quite interesting when I came to Quinns and I got to kind of work with Nick Evans, who was an All Black and who also played with him and like could kind of let me know what Marnie was like as a player and a person.
What did he say he was like? Because he seems like a great bloke.
A man of development. That's kind of the key phrase he used to describe him. Started off from a wing, worked on the skills, worked on the player he wanted to be in, and became the centre that we all know and love.
First time I ever saw him, New Zealand used to do a probables versus possibles, which is similar to the game they did, and he wasn't in the All Blacks team at the time, and I'd never heard of him, and I saw him, I was like, this guy is a...
Yeah.
Lewis is here tonight as well, isn't he?
Yeah, he is here tonight. Yes,
of course, his dad. Oh, he's right here.
He's right behind us. Wow.
Honestly, mate, I was about to slag you off.
Don't worry, it's the traffic.
Barely.
I live 10 minutes away, but you know.
Amazing entrance, though. Amazing entrance.
Just come. It was all planned.
So Lennox has just told us about his first rugby hero, Martin Onu. Who is yours?
Oh, wow. Well, I guess it's probably a cliche one. Probably my dad, but because you know, he played at the highest level possible and won almost everything. So
I'll stop it here, lads. It's raining.
I guess yeah, my dad, which pretty good role model to have. So, but coming on from that, probably I guess Mike Brown is one, playing in the same position now. He's my mentor here. Cullen, the New Zealand fullback. God, those three were mainly just exciting players, and really, and also my dad to have.
When the camera's not rolling, I'm going to tell you the story about the time your dad ruined my birthday.
Brilliant. Was that
World Cup?
World Cup final?
No. It was It was 1991. Wales playing Australia. Anyway, whatever. Yeah. Still cuts deep. You talked about mentors at Quins then. So you both, you got some minutes at the end of last season, which is amazing. And hoping to see you both perhaps side by side in a Quins jersey soon. Yeah. Talk to me about the mentors then. How does it work? Who are you training alongside day by day that the Quins fans might be more familiar with? Starting with you, Lennox.
My biggest mentor, I'd say, coming in was Joe Marchant. At the very beginning, so he spoke to me while I was at school, kind of helped me with things that I didn't really understand, and then coming in, he was a very big voice for me, like letting me know things I could do and couldn't do. But then upon being here for a year, kind of everyone in the backs are real big mentors for us, especially me, I'd say. So like Andre, Taps, Paulie, James Lang, all the 12s and 13s that you see at the club, they're really big for helping me.
Yeah. We both talked to Brownie a lot as well. He's really helped both of us. I feel like helping us integrate with everything. Yeah. Not so much player wise, but like being able to cope with the training demands and what you can do, what you can't do. Like what coach is looking for, and like obviously he's played at the highest level.
And a big
as well.
Part I'd say as well was the mental side of it. Yeah. So obviously rugby is quite a brutal sport, both physically and mentally. Mm. So Brownie's been quite big for us in regards to those things, and helping us kind of develop that kind of facet of the game is quite important.
Well, lads, I'm looking forward to evolving this chat. Get behind these two and the rest of the lads. They're the future of the club, and trust me, the future of the club is bright. We're going to find some ice packs now for Sean, because he has been battered by every swing door in the Stoop whilst we film this piece. But boys, enjoy the game tonight. Thanks for having a chat.
Thank you very much.
Martin Onu and Michael Liner, that's not a bad start to the rugby heroes, is it? I mean what I say with sticking with those lads as well. So many young, talented players coming through the academy, hoping to see them out there doing the business in the not-too-distant future. Remember, keep your rugby heroes coming in, and you could win that brand new For the Oceans third kit before the night is out. Speaking of rugby heroes, one of the unsung heroes is the groundsman here, Paul Sykes, who prepares this incredible surface for us to enjoy rugby week in, week out here at the Twickenham Stoop. I caught up with him later, and hopefully it won't be the last time. Fascinating guy, and I certainly learned a thing or two, so enjoy this. We're going to call it The Grass Chronicles, Volume 1. They literally never let me on the pitch here at the Stoop, so I figured the only way to get access was to have a chat to the main man himself, head groundsman here at Harlequin FC, Paul Sykes. Welcome to Harlequin's Live. Thank you for letting me on what I assume is your pride and joy.
Maybe.
What am I stood on here? Is it perennium ryegrass?
That's perennial ryegrass.
Okay.
Lowlium perennae, and this is Poa annua. That's why England's a green and pleasant land. That's why everywhere's green, but it's actually a weed grass, and it weakens this and causes problems. So that's why we're trying to get rid of this and have more of this.
So is that white line quite literally the difference between the good stuff
and
the bad stuff?
Yeah, pretty much. Actually, it's roughly where my feet are. That's the rye, and that's Poa.
Actually, looking at it, I can see the difference.
I was just about to say, luckily for me, I can see and you can't, but you're learning quick. That's good. I like it. That's good.
It is getting a bit dark. I'm sure if it was daylight, I'd be able to see. Talk to me about preparation. I remember coming here in the summer when rugby was about to restart, and we had glorious sunshine. Pitch looked fantastic. The pitch looks fantastic now. Is it more difficult this time of year?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'm assuming we're having a bit of a COVID talk as well, and how that affects us, and it's massively affected us because it's a winter sport. So what I'm trying to do is work with a living plant, and almost everything that's living goes into stasis around 5 degrees or low, and we're getting there now. We had a bit of a cold snap last night. So I try to get all the work done during the summer, get as many blades, in simple terms, as many blades of grass out there as possible for the boys to kick out and repair it again when it starts growing. So now I've got a bit of a challenge because we're just about to start the season, and I had to get the rest of the last season's games in. And normally when I've got downtime and I'm doing a good long preparation, getting rid of all the Poeranua and starting a new baby. We've had to mix it up this year and adapt and overcome and work on the fly. And thank you for your comments, because the reason we have done a renovation and it's somewhere in the middle, so it's been difficult. So now I've got the challenge now of cramming all those matches into a much shorter period of time when the grass doesn't grow. So I hope this is looking like this next year, but I'm not sure by May.
Well, because you've had a 6-day turnaround, because we had the women's game last
That's
week
right.
where it hammered it down for the whole time. Mm-hmm. It's looking well, we're stood in the rain now. It's looking like we're going to get similar this evening. Mm. Do those playing conditions, if you get 80 minutes of real scrutiny, heavy studs, hard scrummaging, is that going to make your job much more difficult for the weeks and months to come?
Yes and no. It really does depend on all how it lies and all how it happens at the time. The best analogy, I'm an analogy guy, so the best analogy I come up with is when you're walking on the beach, if you're walking or running, say, in the soft sand up at the top, that's hard work, isn't it? Because it's soft and it moves all the way. If you're walking in the sea, same thing, it's too wet and it moves. If you walk right on the line where the tide is, it's very firm because the water helps make it firm. So it really just, this is due to stop any time, and I'm really hoping it will, because then it will actually aid me. It will hold the root zone underneath together. If it then starts raining very heavily right now, I'll be a completely different situation. So really, I always say this, and it annoys some of my bosses, but I've only got one boss, really, and I've got to work on whatever's going on there. It's hard for me to plan and explain to people what I'm going to do. I've got to adapt very quickly and change very quickly. But it helps by being here 12 years and knowing exactly what's going on under there.
Annoyingly, that one doesn't pay the mortgage, which is incredibly frustrating. So let's talk about the pitch in itself then. In terms of the grass that's out here and this awful stuff that's going to be disappearing soon enough, mm-hmm. How much of an input do you have in terms of the selection of ultimately the turf and the grass that is on that pitch that Harlequins play on every week?
Everything.
Okay.
It's one of the few things that I have complete control of in my life, and I'm very happy to be. Let's go back to ryegrass. Why do we use ryegrass?
Yeah.
Ryegrasses have got very thick cell walls because animals have been chewing it and using it as a food crop for years. We found small hybrid, small versions that grow up in the mountains in New Zealand that don't get so much eaten, but the weather makes them dense. So we crossbreed them to take the coarseness out of the animal feed, but then we still end up with a very fine, beautiful grass that can take the wear. So it's such a science these days, you know. So I talk very closely to my seed reps. We have we're very saddles grounds, and we have a book of seed that we all clamber to buy every year, and it's got all the best species that all these mad people like me are testing under crazy conditions, and then we find the one that can take the most wear, the most cold, that stays good colour in when it's dormant. There's lots of factors. How well the roots... one thing we haven't talked about is roots. Most of what I'm doing out here is actually managing what's underneath, not really what's up above, you know. Because I'm trying to get the carbohydrate reserves in there so that it can take all the abuse. You could think of carbohydrate reserves in similar terms as fat and humans. You know, it keeps our energy levels reserved. So I don't want to ever dip into that. And that's why I do such intense work. So
this time of year, I do a lot of my carbohydrate reserves.
Yeah, I know.
As well.
I think especially Christmas.
Do you have a good relationship with other groundsmen there, whether it's in Premiership rugby, whether it's in football or cricket or golf or any of these other sports where the ground is the be-all and end-all?
Absolutely. Yeah, it's a very tight industry, and we've all been to the same colleges. We've all had the same jobs here. There, we all know who's going to what job and everything else. But, you know, I don't want to do too much of a name drop, but I was speaking to the groundsman of Spurs the other night, and he just called me up. How are you doing? And we're having a chat, and I've got moss around here. Do you know a new product? Because I was doing my head in. And we're very sad people, to be fair, but we all look after each other, and it's a nice thing. You know, I like that. There doesn't have to be the elitism of, oh, I'm not going to speak to the rugby groundsman. We're all the same, and we all help each other out, and it's a wonderful feeling.
I could talk to you all day. Will you promise to come back on the show so we can get deeper into this?
Yeah, definitely.
Amazing.
Thank you very much.
This is part one of
the Grass Chronicles. What about
the Grass Chronicles, Volume 1. Sykesy, mate, thank you so much for that chat.
I'd love to shake your hand, but we can't.
Go for one of those from a distance. Cheers.
Thanks, buddy.
Grass Chronicles Volume 1, done and dusted. If you've got a question that you'd like me to pose to him in Volume 2, then get in touch. We're going to be doing Harlequins Live, presented by Silverbug throughout the season. So if there's somebody you want us to question, then make sure you let us know. We really want to sort of reach out, build a relationship with you as supporters and people who watch the show. One man I'm sure you all want to hear from is the head of rugby, Paul Gustard. Entering into his third season, there's always an excitement, and he's made a huge difference here already. This is what he had to say this evening. A new season upon us, but it doesn't feel like a particularly long time since we had a chat like this. How have the past few weeks been?
Short, but intense, you know. It's different, but it's different for every team in the league, of course. Some teams as well, like Exeter, have had shorter preparation than we have, so we don't anticipate or expect too much change from them. For ourselves, we've been focusing a lot on co-creating elements of our attack, redefining some elements of our kicking game, which wasn't up to scratch for a lot of part of last season. Charlie Mulcrone is looking after that for us at the moment, and I think he's doing a great job. So, look, we've redefined how we're trying to play. We're trying to really nail down our identity as a team, and hopefully we can show those elements tonight.
What are those challenges then, the different challenges in that condensed pre-season?
Well, it's just the unknown, you know. Normally you have a period of time that you're accustomed to prepare a team. There's a kind of a natural flow to a pre-season when you get the players back in. Here you've got 4 weeks, so you try and think about the best way to get the team prepared, but you don't know because you've got no life experience on that. So we've had 4 weeks. We didn't do any traditional kind of fitness games and things like that interspersed with rugby. We went straight into rugby and tried to get our fitness as much as possible through our attacking shape, through our defensive formation and so on. So, look, the board's been really good. We're quite encouraged with what we've seen over the last 4 weeks, but you never know till you know. We weren't able to play a pre-season game. Unfortunately, we've got some injuries that in positions which would have meant that we weren't able to do it. So we kind of had a pretty physical body in front game here last week. And as I said, elements of our game are coming together, and they need to come together pretty fast tonight against Exeter.
Looking at tonight's team, there's lots to get excited about. Plenty of experience in there, a new captain, potential debuts off the bench as well. What does this team say about where Harlequins are at the moment?
Look, we're an evolving team, you know. I think I said this the other day, you know, for the last 20 years, Harlequins have only ever finished in the top four times. Three of those were in the kind of period, the golden period of kind of 2011 to 2013. And we haven't reached those heights again, you know, so that's kind of the anomaly for where this club has been. It's our job and our ambition to try and get the club more regularly in that top four and compete for silverware, because that's what we want to do, you know. So I think we've seen an evolution of the squad, you know, more of the elder statesmen have moved on now. And we've got a group of young kids now that have played, you know, 50 games, 60 games for some of them. You know, the likes of Don Brandt, Marchant, Lang, Marcus Smith, of course, Tommy Lauday, Will Evans are coming through to the team now as well, and then the likes of Simon Kerrod into the EPS. So, look, the spine of the team is developing nicely, and, you know, with Steph there, he's got a different style of leadership to Chris, and, you know, he's got a strong ally in Andres, he's a good mate from back home, and obviously we're looking to start with a good performance tonight.
Is there a good time or a better time to play particular teams? And if so, is this a good time to play Exeter Chiefs?
Look, I always look at it. You've got to play every team twice. You know, I think the first thing to look at is what players have you got available. And today we've got a pretty reasonable squad to select from. You normally feel more vulnerable when you feel depleted. You know, for at least a third to almost a half the season last season. You know, from probably October onwards, we had very limited numbers to train with and limited numbers to select from. So you do feel a bit more nervy against certain teams on that occasion, just due to the makeup of their team more than anything else. Whereas today, as I said, we've got a stronger squad to pick from. We're pretty comfortable with the team that we've picked. And, you know, it's a team more than capable of beating Exeter. We've done that. You know, we've probably been one of the teams that have been a bit more successful against Exeter over the last 2-3 seasons, and you know, that doesn't count for anything. The score starts at 0-0, and it's important that we start well tonight.
Plenty of new faces came in before rugby restart. One that really sticks out is Scott Steele, who's missing this evening because he's on international duty, and a couple of new faces that we'll be seeing that you've signed in the last few days. A quick word on those two.
Well, I mean, the two kind of short-term signs we've got are Joe Rafter, who's a young prop from Bedford Blues. With Joe Marlowe away, we don't have any academy loose head. It's something we're working hard on trying to increase the depth in our academy programme. So it leaves us pretty vulnerable, so we need to get somebody in. Joe's needs to be conditioned, so we're working hard on that to make sure that he's not feeling unsafe when he goes into the field. And then after that, we signed Will Edwards on a short-term deal. So Will, I've kind of known for on and off for 10 years now. So when I was a coach at Saracens, he was coming through the academy pathway. Likened a lot to young Alex Good. He moves a bit like him, and he's got a beautiful core skill set. Obviously, played 3.5 years at elite level in sevens. His resilience is massive because you're on the road a lot, you're away from home. You have to get your own bits and pieces sorted, and you're on travel and that kind of stuff organised. And obviously, with the sevens program closing down, he's had to deal with that adversity. And he's just a great kid. So, hopefully, we're a club that can get something out of him. And he misses out on selection tonight, but I'm sure that our fans will see him over the next few weeks.
Good luck tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Always great to hear from Guzzy. And if you're not optimistic about this season after that conversation, then I don't know what will get you in the mood. He talked about new leadership. He talked about a playing identity. And we are entering into a new era. And a new captain, Steph Levies, leaves the team out for the first time this evening. Another leader who's starting in the sixth jersey is Tom Lauday. We caught up with both of them before kickoff this evening.
Yeah, Friday night lights. Awesome to be back at the Stoop. Obviously sad not having any fans here, or we love having the fans here, but that we know they'll be watching back at home, so really excited just to get back to the pitch and do what we love. Boys are buzzing. We obviously worked extremely hard over the last 3 weeks, so to finally get out here and see what we worked on, put it to the test against a quality side, yeah, really excited. I think as a player you love a short pre-season, so no complaints there. But we really worked hard, we put a lot of effort into our detail around the rugby, a lot more rugby, not just normal fitness. So we've worked hard on our detail and we'll put that into practice tomorrow. Double champions, huge respect for Exeter. I think more of the same. I don't think they would have changed much, they're a well-polished side. So I think what we've seen over the last season, just more of that coming into this season. Yeah, massively confident. I think we have an exciting team. If you look at the spine there with Dom Brand at 8, Danny Kerr 9, Marcus 10, those are exciting players. I think it will be a group effort tomorrow, team effort from us. But all in all, really excited, class team.
Yeah, really excited. The new season's going to be starting obviously tomorrow night. Back at the Stoop, Friday Night Lights. Boys are really up for it. Playing against the double champions obviously. So yeah, it couldn't be better really. We've worked really hard over the last few weeks. It's been a short, sharp pre-season. We've taken in a lot of information from the coaches. We're all on the same page. We've got a clear game plan. Steph stepped up into the captaincy role really well. It's all kind of clicking, and we're really excited to get out there tomorrow to hopefully show everyone, how hard we've been working. Building momentum going on into Europe, I guess, as well. The first couple of games, it's really important to get good showings, get some good rugby played, and the results ultimately to get some wins. The back row boys got together during the week and kind of discussed who we're going to potentially be up against, where their strengths and weaknesses are, where our strengths and weaknesses are, and we've kind of come up with a few bits and pieces where we can hopefully get the upper hand. The other two that are completing the back row with myself are very exciting. Weather over the ball, Dommer's hitting his lines and getting his hands on the ball. So if those two can show up, then it should be pretty entertaining. Everyone's on the same page. We've got a clear structure, a clear game plan going into the season. I've never been more confident of the squad, where it is at the moment. We've got so much talent in this squad. So much talent across the board. So if we all turn up like we hope we will, then yeah, I think we'll be able to get the W.
It would not be a Harlequins live without welcoming the Queen of the Stoop, Rachel Burford. You thought you got away with that because we chatted last week before your win against Sail Sharks, and I didn't call you the Queen of the Stoop, but it feels like an apt return for the nickname. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. Great to be back at the Stoop. Great to have the live rugby back on again, and can't wait to watch the boys tonight.
Not just the Queen of the Stoop, but the Queens of the Premier 15s at the moment. 5 wins from 5. You're top of the shop. It's a pretty good time to be part of Quinn's Women.
Yeah, we've started really well. Obviously, 5 from 5, bonus point wins as well. We've travelled away from home, got 2 good wins there, and you know, playing at the Stoop, our 2 games, made sure nobody's crossed that whitewash. So we're in a good place, but I think we've still got plenty more to grow, lots more to give, and I think that's what's really exciting about this side, is that we're doing well, but we're nowhere near our potential yet.
If you didn't watch last Saturday, we've got a date for your diary, 5th of December. We're back here at the Stoop. We're live streaming the game against Gloucester Hartbury Women. Really good numbers. Lots of people watched. Lots of people enjoyed. Seemed like a big game for the team as well, because there were a lot of girls involved with England duty. It was a chance for people to shine, and everyone stepped up.
Yeah, it was a huge opportunity to see the depth in our squad. We had a lot of players away on international duty, doing a very good job out in France, beating France. But it gave everybody an opportunity, a new look for Gerard, to be able to see players, how they've developed over training, over pre-season, because it is different doing something in training to doing it out on the pitch. And every single player did themselves justice. You know, we talked about we haven't reached our potential yet, but week on, week out, we're seeing improvements, we're seeing progress, and that's exactly what both Gerard Mullin and Karen Finley want to be seeing, that actually each week we're getting better and we're getting better each time we take the field.
Well, a weekend off, a bit of a busman's holiday for you, because you've come down to the Stoop anyway. What are the rest of the girls going to be up to this weekend? And do you miss not playing when the season's up and running?
Yeah, I think, you know, you get into a good habit of weekends being your rugby weekends, and that's why I'm here, because I love it. But yeah, I think most of the girls will be fully behind our internationals who are playing on Saturday, so we'll be tuning into BBC Two to watch that. We've had a really good training week. We've had a lot of opportunity to like look at some of the details that we may not have been able to do beforehand, so it's been a great training week, and now everybody's got an opportunity to switch off this week, come back in on Tuesday, 100% effort going into that game against Gloucester Hartbury on the weekend
for another 5 points,
we hope.
We're going to chat to Berth about the photo shoot that she was on yesterday. Remember, you've got the opportunity to win the brand new third kit. It's nice, isn't it?
It's really nice.
All you have to do is let us know who your rugby hero is. If you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, just type it into the chat box and we'll be drawing that out. Who's your rugby hero all time?
Oh, it's tough, because I think, like, obviously naturally your family, so my dad and my mum and everybody, but when I was a little girl growing up, I used to love Mickey Skinner. I don't know if it was because of his mullet and I like that look, but yeah, he was my go-to. I just loved how everybody used to call him the Munch, and watching him, you know, on TV at my local rugby club, hearing them go, oh, every time they made me tackle, I think that just drew me into him, but definitely the mullet had something to do with it, I think.
I've got a really vivid image of Mickey Skinner at some kind of black tie do, but with a £50 note crumpled up for a bow tie.
Sounds about right.
Yeah, it does, yeah. Anyway, the shoot's amazing. Let's take a look at it now. It was the launch yesterday. It's made all out of recycled materials. It's for the oceans. This is the brand new Harlequins third kit. Looked awesome. You were actually underwater, right?
Yes, completely underwater. As far as photo shoots goes, that definitely has to be the best one. Yeah, a little bit of scuba diver down underneath the water with you. But yeah, you had to fully submerge yourself and try and perform all the movements underwater that, you know, used to pass on the pitch, not underwater. But it was really, really good fun. And absolutely love the kit. It's so nice. And I just love the initiative. You know, so much plastics in our ocean, let's do something about it. And it's awesome that Quinn's and Adidas are doing that.
So what was the brief then? Just get in the water and look like a rugby player?
Yeah, we had a few that, you know, you had to be in a certain area of the pool, and there's some shots where you had to jump in and then you had to kind of explode forward as fast as you can. But they did say it won't be like normal running. It was a lot of hard work. I kept coming up for air and being like, whoa. He said, it's harder than you think, isn't it? But it was really, really good fun, really well looked after, and it was great to be involved in it.
Spoke to the chief exec, Laurie, earlier about initiatives like this. So the first team in Premiership Rugby to have that recycled material jersey, the only team team to have the sort of exclusivity with Movember, with the first team back under the lights on the TV cameras. It's a heck of a club here, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. And I think they go to extra lengths to make those things possible, to be the first here, to be the first doing that. And that's what makes it so special. And, you know, and that's why we love our fans. We love the Stoop and we love being here, because the club goes above and beyond.
I'm looking forward to catching up with you in the game. It's freezing cold. I'm going to crack in a minute and put my gloves on, and I'm going to be sat in the stands, but we're going to be sending you out and about, pretty much because you've got a friendlier face and we think people will talk to you during the game.
Hopefully, we'll see.
More great initiatives don't just come from the players here. They also come from the Harlequins Foundation. I've already mentioned that Movember deal that we have here, and a main exponent of that, of course, is Mark Leckie, the head of the foundation, and this is what he had to say when we caught up earlier today. Mark, welcome back to the Stoop. But when was the last time you were here in a professional or non-professional capacity?
Well, I didn't look quite as old as I do right now, so it was the last game before lockdown 1.0.
We got loads to talk about today, but let's start with the t-shirt next to you. It's the Movember match. It's a huge thing that's really sort of caught fire with rugby. It's something that really resonates with supporters and players alike. So what is Harlequin's involvement and the foundation's involvement today?
So we've got a partnership with Movember. We're the only rugby club in the world at the moment, and we're piloting a programme called Ahead of the Game. In fact, we've just finished the pilot. The t-shirts the players are going to wear today, the significance of the 60 is that we lose 60 men to suicide every hour across the world, so there's a real big number, and it's around raising awareness around self-harm and suicide. And the programme we deliver is about equipping young athletes in our community clubs with the knowledge and dispelling some myths around anxiety and depression. But it's not only just the young athletes, it's also providing the parents and the coaches with that knowledge as well, so the three parties can speak confidently with each other, and hopefully we can help support young athletes and their mental wellbeing.
So Quinn's being the only club in the world with that partnership, obviously that's something that you're very proud of, but is that something that you want to remain exclusive, or would you like other clubs, other teams, organisations to have similar partnerships?
I mean, I feel like a Bond villain when I say that, but no, most definitely. It's also being trialled through some governing bodies. So the New Zealand Rugby Union are doing a similar programme. It's been run through Australian football or Aussie Rules football, and the Rugby League World Cup are delivering it next year as well. So it most definitely is about trying to work out what works well, tweaking it and then delivering it across as many clubs and providing that knowledge so that we can help save lives.
So the players are going to be warming up in those t-shirts today. Is there anything that Quinn's fans, Quinn's members can do?
Yeah, so we've got a number of our fundraising initiatives. So if you care to join the Mighty Draw that is launching again tonight, you can do that. And we've got our goal giving initiative as well. So we've got a number of our fundraising and programmes. There's the pin badges that we're selling at the moment. And you can also donate to the team. So there's a number of the team are either growing, moving or hosting for our Movember. See how I did that then? And you can go onto our website and donate, and any donation is much appreciated, and it will all go towards that particular programme and help support and hopefully save some young people's lives.
Now, I love charity, but I also love winning a few quid. So tell me about the Mighty Draw.
The Mighty Draw, it's been going a couple of seasons now, and we've now moved it to some cash prizes. So you can purchase a ticket, or several tickets if you so choose, and the draw is at half time. And this season it's also going to be home and away games. So again, all that money will be invested into the foundation programmes, hopefully it's a bit of fun as well for our supporters.
I'm trying to avoid using words like unprecedented, because I'm as fed up of them as the next man. But the last 6, 7, 8 months have been different for sport, have been difficult for charity. How have you been affected, and have you still been able to do all of the great community work that you do with the foundation?
Of course we've been affected, but you know, both on an individual and personal level, we've all been affected within the club and in the wider community. Naturally, we've all felt the ramifications of the pandemic. But what we, on a positive note, we've been really, really encouraging plays. I mean, my team have been different class. The team, the wider team in the club have been unbelievable. The support the club is still giving us as the foundation in the situation they find themselves is unparalleled, and I genuinely mean that, even though I'm on Quinn's Live and I'm sat in the Stoop and their ears. But the support we're getting is unparalleled. And what we've what I'm really pleased about is, in if any of the team are, I'm so proud of them in how they have adapted so quickly to delivering online, you know, whether it's our education programs or our wellbeing programs, the calling campaign, to delivering food to over 75 year old vulnerable people in the Hounslow community, or to our events and fundraising that our events team have quickly turned on to become virtual. All of that stuff, we actually, I was looking at it yesterday, I've got a board next week, and in the board papers I realised that we have had as much impact during this period of time, in a different way, but as much impact in the number of people we've seen and the delivery we've done, as we had expected to before the pandemic, which is testament to all the hard work of the team, and I'm incredibly proud and really, really pleased that we can take that position and I think really start to have an impact on the community.
Well, because I was going to ask you who benefits from the Harlequins Foundation, but just in that few sentences then, you talked about young people and the educational benefits and the elderly people who are getting food delivered. Like, your reach is huge.
Mm. It's a constant tension we have. You know, what we want to do is we can't be all things to all people, but we have an opportunity to leverage the unique position we have in the community to have a really broad, almost have a broad church of interventions and not limit ourselves to a particular area. But getting that message across to everyone can be quite challenging. So we know what we do internally, and sometimes we forget that we have to really clearly convey those messages to the wider supporter base. But yeah, it's pretty vast. Broadly into three areas: skills, well-being and inclusion, which hopefully are names that people recognise. And skills really is our education and training and programmes, which are targeting those marginalised, furthest from the job market, perhaps excluded from mainstream education, finding kind of traditional education or training pathways challenging. So we're doing that intervention. Our well-being is through programmes like that November partnership, but also physical programmes that might deal with long-term health conditions and providing that support and doing it in a setting such as this, or using the brand of Harlequins, we find gets us cut through into the communities that traditional statutory agencies may not be able to achieve. And the inclusion bit is really working with those groups who might traditionally be underrepresented in playing and or watching rugby. So whether it's minority ethnic groups, whether it's people who live in what the class is low socioeconomic areas, which is where I came up, you know, in a council estate, our disability work that we do. So really trying quite a broad suite of programmes, trying to target it into those who are going to benefit the most. And I'm really pleased in such a short space of time, really, in the grand scheme of things, as the organisation, we're really punching above our weight.
You also do brilliant work to get the supporters involved. So finally then, every time I go on the social media, I see a great Harlequins Foundation event. So for the people who are watching who might not have been involved with one, what are a few of those events and how can Quinn's supporters get involved?
So, yeah, there's some events we put on. There's other events that some of the supporter organisations are doing. So Quinza are supporting us through an event they've got in a couple of weeks. They can just have a look on our socials, sign up for our newsletter, because you'll get all of that information through. We've had Evenings With, so we had a great one. The last one was actually around November again. We had Jade Conkle, Leah Lyons, Martin Landaggio, James Chisholm, Joe Gray, all talking about their experiences around resilience and sport. So you get a real nice insight into not only Quinn's life, but also outside off the pitch. And we've got a wine tasting event that's been supported by, it wouldn't be Quinn's if it wasn't a wine tasting event. And we've got loads and loads of bits and pieces that have really pivoted to a kind of virtual engagement. And hopefully, if with a fair wind and if all things are true, as has been reported in the media, and we can get this vaccine going, we'll have some live events further on in the year, such as our rival ride, and that'll be actually the last home game of the season. Little insight here for you, hasn't even been announced, is the plan, and we'll be doing a big leaving and arriving back at the Stoop. I haven't had any of that approved by anybody at the club yet, but we'll see.
But I do feel like we've just got a scoop. So
I think so. You heard it here first, people.
Thanks for your time, Mark. Enjoy the game tonight and keep up the good work.
Cheers. Come on, you Quins.
Counting down to kickoff then, it's Harlequins Live, presented by Silverbug. The lights are on, the music's on, you're already at home. We really wish that you could be joining us here at the Stoop, but it's people, watching rugby. I promised you great guests, and I've got two right next to me now. Ashy, Big Tex, great to have you on board, gentlemen.
Thank you.
I see that neither of you, despite the best efforts of the club, have gone for the full-on Movember.
I can't. I'll be here till next November before anything shows up.
Big efforts from all the boys, though. I can see they're out there warming up. They're in the T-shirts with the 60 on the back. The club have really got behind it, haven't they? Yes, no? Can you hear me, boys? Can you boys
hear me?
Oh, you can hear me. We're speaking into this microphone, so you've got your pilot's thing on there, mate. We're not flying helicopters today. We've got the handheld microphone, so we're all right. I spoke to Gussie about this earlier. It's been a different pre-season. What have you had, 4 or 5 weeks since the last game? Does that mean you've had a bit less of a fitness beasting than you normally would going into a season?
I think it's actually only been 3 weeks. It's not been much at all.
No.
Yeah.
So it's obviously very strange because, I associate the weather really with pre-season and it being warm, and that's when we train and do fitness. But now it's been relatively cold. So it has been a bit strange, and it's even more strange to get back into games at this time of the year. But I think 3 weeks has been enough. It's probably enough time for us to just change a couple of bits in what we want to do and how we want to play. Enough time to, I think, any longer than 3 weeks, coaches get too giddy. they want to take too much fitness, eh, Tex?
Yeah, that's true. I really enjoyed this pre-season, but there's not much training done.
Yeah.
There's less fitness, but a little bit more training, more like rugby-related. For the big boys, we're really happy.
Speaking of big boys, you've gone and got yourself a big boy injury. Is it the right leg that's keeping you out this one?
Yes, I've got a hematoma on the right leg, so getting it drained like few weeks now. So hopefully next week or the following week should be ready.
There was me thinking you'd been on the squats and just got yourself a bit of extra, but it's hematoma. And when can we expect to see you back on the pitch?
I will be training next week, so I don't know, hopefully the week after, I think, is the latest.
I mean,
we'll be back together.
Yes.
Hey, we're coming in, yeah.
I'm just waiting for text.
So that's when the tries are going to come, right?
Yeah.
You've both been in the game a long time now, and the way professional rugby is now, it's impossible to play every minute of every game. Do you miss playing, or are you kind of happy to sit the odd week out?
I think now we're here and we can see it. I think when we've got pre-season and stuff, we probably don't miss it too much.
Yeah, exactly.
I think this is probably my 15th, 16th.
Yeah.
So yeah, I've had enough of them, but now we're here and we're at the game and you see the lads warming up for the match and getting dressed and stuff. Yeah, you miss that because you want to be part of that. That's why we train, that's why we play. I think that the match days while we play, we both could easily probably not train and just
train and play. Exactly. I was going to say rather just wait for the game and play rather than
just have the week off with the feet up and then Friday night or Saturday afternoon rolls around and you do the business. What about the Oppo tonight? I look over there, they're just getting that scrum warmed up. This is a Harlequins show and we're going to spend all evening talking about Harlequins, but we need to spend a few minutes on them because what they ended up doing last season, that was pretty exceptional, wasn't it?
It was. Amazing, really, considering where they've come from, being in the Championship, and now to win both Europe and Premiership together is amazing for such what started out to be such a little club of Exeter. It's not got the history of a Harlequins. Not necessarily had, no they have, but they haven't had the past players that this club has had, so to build what they have over such a short period of time is incredible, and they deserve the win with the squad that they've got now. It's full of international players, so yeah, it is amazing. It's a big challenge for us tonight to beat a team like that.
Yeah, but last time they came here, what happened?
When was it? My years are all over the place here.
Well, last time they came here, I was setting you up for the big one there because we won and you scored. That's what I was getting at. I put it on a plate for you. Absolutely put it on a plate for you and you've looked at me. Unbelievable. But no, that heck of a game went down to the very last penalty try. Obviously, your five-pointer. We won by four, so you could say that wouldn't have won without you. The question I was teeing up to were, what are your memories of that game? But by the sounds of things, you haven't got any memories of it at all.
I think because of Exeter coming in, they were like favourites.
Yeah.
And the boys rose up to that. And knowing that they're a very tough side, so we had to show up. And it was one of our biggest games and like one of our memorable ones, because it was my first try for Queens. So I think it was very exciting. And then we came out on top in the end. So.
First of many tries for Quinns. Very much looking forward to you adding to the ledger. I'm not one of those people who's going to sit here and be like, oh, you know, what do you want to do this season? Do you want to make playoffs? Do you want to go far in Europe? Do you want to win the Premiership? But there does seem like a bit of a buzz about this season. It does feel as though there are a group of players here that can turn out every weekend and put on a good show. Would you say that's a fair assessment of where we are going into this season?
Yeah, I think that's always a Quinn's way, isn't it, to try and put on a show? It's a funny one because every team has a buzz at the start of the season, yeah. And every team thinks they're going to go well, unfortunately. Otherwise, we wouldn't be playing professional rugby. So, it depends on...
Depends on this game. So it depends on your first game.
Yeah.
So it's like, that's why it's very important to set the tone for the season. So that's why today is a big game for us and for them as well. So for our group, I think tonight is going to be an indication of how far we can go.
What's more important in that first game then? The performance or the score?
Performance for me, definitely. Just from where we finished off back end of last season, losing a couple of key games. What reminds me most is the one at home at Bath. So I think it's definitely performance focused at the minute. We've got a good mix of young players coming through. They just need to keep building on that experience. And yeah, so for me, definitely performance.
Well, let's take a look at both the teams who will be starting the match this evening then. A lot of familiar faces in the Quinns lineup, a lot of new ones too. Garcia, Botta, Baldwin and Vilko packed down as a front row for the first time. Steph Lavis takes his inaugural bow as captain with Simo next to him in the row. Lorde starts at six alongside, well, against his former employers. He's joined by Will Evans at seven. Don Brant's at eight because somehow he's still not in Eddie Jones's squad. Brownie and Danny Keir bookend the back line. 621 Quinns appearances between them. A new centre partnership with Esterhuizen and Luke Northmore, of course, Marchie on England duty. Marcus Smith at 10, a clean points ledger for him. It was 198 last season. I'm sure he'll be eyeing up that 200. And then Caden Murley and Nathan Earl with the pace out wide. Exeter Chiefs, 6 of today's starting 15. We're in that 15 that lifted the Heineken Champions Cup in October. Two of those are Alex Hepburn and Harry Williams. They're either side of Jack Yendall in the front row this evening. Will Whitty and Don Armand are a new look engine room in front of Dave Ewers, Yanis Kirsten and Sam Simmons. That's the trusted back row that started in the Premiership final. The win just over the way there at Twickenham Stadium. No surprises at halfback. Maunder at 9, Simmons at 10 and lots of experience in midfield for them. Devoto and Witten at 12 and 13 in midfield. Woodburn and O'Flaherty on the wings and then Facundo Cordero at 15, younger brother, of course, of Chiefs fan favourite Santi, 21 years of age, just his third appearance. Game changers and potential for debuts for Jack Stafford and Tyrone Green. Exciting for those boys, particularly for Jack, because he came in after the restart. He's seen a lot of rugby, he's got to know the boys, but he's been made to wait. If he does get on the pitch this evening, that's a big moment for him, isn't it?
Yeah, of course. He came over on trial, so he's taking his opportunity, which is always good to come. And I think when you're on a shut, well, I wouldn't know, unfortunately, but you have to prove yourself quickly and you have to fit in quickly. And he definitely does that. He's a real good personality. He gets on with everyone in the squad, and he's a good person to have around. And you can see in training and stuff, he wants to push the other nines. Scott Steele comes in and done a great job, but he wants to keep pushing them. He's young enough and hopefully he's going to be good enough to be around for his chance to get the first team spot.
Now, Big Tex, keep your eyes on the screen because we've got highlights of the last time Exeter visited the Stoop. This man crosses the whitewash. It was one of the best victories in the Gallagher Premiership for Harlequins last season. Here are some of the highlights from Harlequins 34, Exeter Chiefs 30.
To by Tom Penny. He'll have an important role today defensively in Quinn's midfield. Nice Chiefs early pressure stemming from a kickoff that wasn't gathered by Harlequins, and look at this from Dolben charging through. Oh, he's not far off 35. He's just stepped through like he's a teenager. What a start for the Chiefs. Front rows have gone down again. Chiefs first, Kerr takes it quickly. Lasiki! Bowling balls his way through. Sam Simmons defending on the other side, and Dom Brandt controlling it to Kerr again, and Lasicki once more! Oh!
Short.
Just short. Still, Quinn's pressing. Well, it may well be Thav and Barty who's got there.
There's a chance to check then, fellas, up you get. Hey, I'm going to check
that. And he's not been with us long, old Tex, but he might be a try scorer.
Coming up to you, Nige. I've got a ball grounded on the line. I just want to check how he got there, please. So, on-field decision is try. Just make sure that he got there without double movement.
TMO, by the way, is Nigel Carrick.
Baldwin, decision, I think it is, does a huge job here of protecting him.
Protecting the camera angle.
The on-field decision's a try, so they've got to see something to overrule it. There isn't anything to overrule it, I don't think.
And award the try.
Okay, great, thank you.
Witten's waiting. He's got Tyone just beyond him.
What's up? No, say that.
White cuts back the other way, and Simmons, there's a lot of room. Woodburn was waiting and he wasn't needed.
Exeter, once they get into the red zone, they don't panic, they don't try and force it. And in the end, Joe Simmons, lovely inside-outside break, just holds the defence.
And then the other Simmons.
Yes, we are.
Involving O'Flaherty.
We're still under advantage, Nick.
Vermeulen. They did really nicely to find Tyone. Tyone takes on Ibitoy and goes beyond Ibitoy, goes through Ibitoy. That's a wonderful run from Elvis Tyone. Chiefs are stoking the fire right now. Once again, Simmons. Oh, he's snaking his way through. Oh, he's scored another. He's doing this all on his own at the moment. An hour gone. Quinn's having to come from behind again. And then Dombrak to Kerr and Smith, and using Saili as the dummy. And now it's Smith! It's becoming a day for magical young number 10s.
Oh, there's no one more lethal at controlling the pace of his running than Marcus Smith. Just has this glide step. Here comes the power in front of him. Two power runners, and he just puts that hitch kick in that he's famed for and glides to the outside.
Set!
Try and create maybe a bit more room for Saili on this right. Dom Brandt to pick.
And Heron goes to the right. Chiefs push hard. And it's a penalty try! In the end, Christoph Ridley's patience runs out. It's a fourth try for Queens. It's a bonus point win. It's an extraordinary finish. And it is the rarest of rare. Chiefs defeats on the road. What a conclusion to this match.
I would say I'd take that again this evening, but I'm not sure the old ticker could go through that. A penalty try in the 80-something minute. Lads, get your headsets back on. I need you for a live show. The big theme this evening is rugby heroes, and we are encouraging people to let us know their rugby heroes. And if you are just tuning in, you could be leaving with this shirt this evening. If you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, tell us your rugby hero. We'll enter them all into a prize draw, and the winner will get this. It's the brand new third kit. It's made out of recycled materials. It's for the oceans. Quinns, once again, doing bits, trendsetters. Really smart new kit, actually, isn't it? Really
nice. Very nice. I like it.
Who are your rugby heroes, then, lads?
Mine was Westala Serevi.
Of course.
I was, so in Fiji, 15s was not even big back then. So yeah. Now we got like
players all over the world. So back then it was just sevens.
Yeah.
So Ursula Seraven, William Ryder was my hero growing up. Yeah.
They'll probably be heroes, a lot of the English lads as well, actually. What about you? Any rugby league boys in the...
Yeah, it'd be probably Jason Robinson, Martin O'Fire.
I tell you what, Robbo was on a podcast. I'm not going to plug other people's work, but he was on a podcast this week. Didn't he speak brilliantly?
I saw it, yeah. He did. He's passionate about it. You can see that. And I think he's got a point on a lot of what he said. It's a shame that that's the way it is. And maybe some things do need to change that department.
What I will say about Robbo as well is I grew up as a bit of a parochial Welshman in a small town in South Wales. Obviously, where Wales weren't very good back then. England were. And I used to watch him. I was like, oh, he's not that good. He was that good, wasn't he? Like, how good was Jason Robinson back in the day?
Absolute freak of nature. Yeah, the way he could find space and move at speed was... I don't think we've ever seen it again. Probably the closest we have to it right now is probably Anthony Watson.
Yeah.
He just hasn't got that...
Speed,
yeah.
Speed, yeah. Speed
to find a gap.
The good thing about him is that when it changes... Speed is still the same, so yeah. He was like, nowadays it's like they slow down and they try, like he was just like bang bang gone, like
he was way ahead of his time.
Yeah.
Oh, what's amazing about that as well is sometimes he'd land and it would look like he landed flat footed,
yeah.
But then he'd just be away straight up to full tilt again.
Do you think it's because of the league training? Because the league training is really fast, very is it? Or
no, you know, I think it was just the complete genetic freak.
Okay. Yeah.
You okay. Look at him now, he just still looks like he could play. Amazing.
He probably could. I tried to get him in a wheelchair, rugby chair once, yeah. But he didn't have it. It's just as well, because he'd have probably destroyed me on that as well. Jason Robinson. All right, well, boys, if you want to win the shirt, I'm sure you've got plenty of stash, but let us know your rugby heroes.
Lovely.
This is the jersey right here.
Hold it up.
Yeah, you hold it up.
All right.
It's a large. Would you get in a large?
2XL. That's just probably a medium.
So that is the jersey. That, in fact, we're going to be wearing it for the first time. I say we, like they're going to trust me anywhere near it. It is going to be the Munster game on the 20th. That's going to be the first European game. That's when the players will be out in it first. But you could be leaving with it today. Just let us know your rugby hero. We've had all kinds, actually. Who did? So we spoke to a couple of the academy lads. Lewis Liner trod the party line. He said his dad, Michael. Lennox said Ma Nonu. That's a good rugby hero. What a player Ma was.
Yeah. I like Lennox.
Oh,
he's a good
player.
Yeah, I do like Lennox. He wants to find things out, and he's keen to train and get better. And he came and asked me about Ma, actually.
Did he?
Yeah, he asked me about him and what he was good at and how he could be more like him, and I told him what I thought.
What I like about talking to you is you can let me know exactly how much you want me to know, because there's no way you're going to tell me what you thought of Ma Nonu. There's absolutely no chance.
Ma, I thought, was one of the best players I've ever seen, to be honest.
Okay.
There's nothing he couldn't do.
Nice, yeah. Remarkable.
And I saw him and played with him at the age of 36, and he still astounded me with some of the stuff that he did.
When a young player comes up to you and asks you what you think of a player, are you not tempted to say, oh, forget about them, mate, just watch me on a Saturday? Just watch me.
No, you know, actually, I really liked it. I'd like them all to do that.
Yeah.
I did. I really appreciate that Lennox just came over and even asked the question. It just shows to me that he's willing and wanting to find out more about it.
He's been on the show, actually. He spent a half with us. Spoke brilliantly, like student of the game. Hopefully he's got a big future.
He's definitely built for it. He's in good condition. He's walking past us right now. He's a big lad, and he wants to train, which is the main thing.
You say he's a big lad. He's 102 kilos, right? But Big Andre, who plays in the same position with him, is a lot more than 102 kilos. He's an absolute monster.
Yeah.
Also, don't forget the monsters over there, mate. They come in.
Yeah.
Absolutely monsters.
Yeah, Andre's a bit of a one-off for a back.
Yeah.
They should be in the forwards, those lads. But Andre, to refer to him as well, he's got some skills.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to seeing him tonight.
Yeah.
And I'd imagine the kind of player with his physicality who you're looking forward to. Oh, here we go. Teams are on their way out. Steph the Beast leads them for the first time.
Let's go, boys.
We've got fireworks. We've got flames.
Oh,
It's the Gallagher Premiership season. This is Harlequins Live, presented by Silverbug. We've got Big Tex, we've got Ashley. I can't wait for this. But sorry, just got caught out there. But somebody like Andre, I bet you're looking forward to playing outside him, because he's going to be looking to get those offloads away, bust the tackle. Could be a lot of five-pointers in your ledger this season.
Yeah, I hope so. He came, obviously, towards the end of the back end of the season, so he's had a little bit more time to settle in now, and the lads have got used to him in training a little bit and how he wants the ball and how he wants to play. So I'm hoping tonight we see a lot more of him. Like I say, he's a big unit, so he'd be useful if he could get the ball to him.
Let's go then. If you're just tuning in, welcome everyone. You're watching people watching rugby. Enjoy the game, boys. Really looking forward to this. We're kicking off. Smithy's kicking towards the stadium. Our view, if you're watching on BT tonight, our view is exactly the same as yours. So we're in the same stand. Chiefs all in white. Quinn's in the quarters.
Silent.
It is. Ah, a little change of direction.
Here we go, here we go. Get him.
That's it. Kick off into the 22. Look for a bit of physicality early on. Smithy going out to defend on the left wing, actually. So Caden Murley's tucking in one.
Nice Simo. Lovely chop, man. Lovely.
Andre's in the backfield.
Yeah. Give him a run up.
Yeah, that's the idea.
First touch then. Jack Maunder.
He's slow as ever, Exeter. Caterpillar. Thought that was banned.
They're a difficult team to rush, aren't they? Oh, Brownie's. Oh, it wasn't Brownie, was it? It was early. He's gone.
It's a long way for him to come and catch that. Yeah. I don't think it was really his ball to catch.
Well, we'll have a first look at the scrub. It's a new look, but old look front row. We know them all well. They're all good scrummagers, but it's the first time they've been a three.
It was Nathan, actually.
Yeah, it was Nathan, yeah. Nathan. He is one who's gone for the Movember. Oh, no, it's still on the chin as well. I just saw the top lip.
I think we can expect to see a lot of that from Exeter tonight, setting up six-man rucks to kick a box kick.
You know what you're going to get with them, don't you?
Yeah, especially when they have some players away. That's what they go to, just to be safe.
And they have got some players away this evening. And they've won the penalty from the scrum. Christoph Ridley in charge tonight. Making friends in southwest London.
Tex, you might have a clue what's going on there, mate.
Oh, mate. This is typical.
Just to start off penalty from the ref.
Yeah, exactly. Ref, that's a bullshit call from the ref, to be honest. It should be a restart.
It is only 7:45, so that's your first and last BS. You're not. You can't say that. Okay, let's one look at one set piece, then one look at the other. Bit scrappy. Oh, it's come back our way.
Lovely.
Here we go.
It's good contesting. Man.
And a high tackle there? No? No, not going to give that. Okay, DC's in. No one's at home. Little challenge here.
Nice, Nate. Hit him. Lovely, Nate. Oh, beautiful. Hit from Nate.
Nice. Great chase.
Yes.
Oh, and it's gone our way. Here we go.
Another scrum.
There's going to be a lot of scrums tonight.
Now, we have got a microphone on one of the water carriers this evening. And we're going to be hearing from them during the water break. But if we could turn them off now, that would be great, because they're so loud in my ear.
G, I can hear you.
So if we could...
G?
If...
Is it G?
Can everybody hear that? I hope he says something ridiculous.
Right. I've just turned that down. Can you still hear that, Ashley? You shouldn't be able to now. Right, so we're going to hear from the water boy during the water break. That, do you know what? We should just forget us and just leave that microphone on live for the whole game.
Graham gets really into the game, so he's shouting and abusing people.
Well, whenever there's a stoppage, we're gonna bring him in. So during the water breaks... Behind enemy lines. Well, it's not enemy lines, is it? We'll try and sneak one on the opposition next week.
Come on, boy. Big scrum.
If you are tuning in for the first time, you're wondering what this is. This is Harlequins Live. Every home game this season, Premiership games and European games. I'm going to be joined by a couple of Harlequin stars, bringing you exclusive behind-the-scenes access. And hopefully some wins as well, because that's what we want. Right. Second scrum. Oh. Ball's not even in and it's already down. Oh, we get the penalty now. Okay.
Good call, ref.
Right, points or corner? What do you think?
It's a big kick.
Corner.
It's not a good confidence boost if he misses it. That's the only thing. I'd go corner if I could, but it looks like he's going for the posts. Good on him. Good to see that he thinks he can nail it. We don't want to see too many of these scrums, do
we? No, it's no fun.
It is no fun.
Also, you can't blame the surface either, because Sykesy's done a great job.
Yeah,
looks
perfect.
Amazing. Right, two scrums, two penalties. Welcome back to Gallagher Premiership Rugby, everyone.
Into it. Middle of November. This could be it for the next few months.
At least it's not raining, mate. Last year it was raining.
Don't you curse
it,
mate.
Oh, my God. I thought I was in Wales.
Hey.
I thought I was in Wales.
Mate, let's not fall out. Come on. Come on. Right, first kick. Smithy, 198 points last year. Only Reese Priestland was ahead of him. And if we hadn't shipped all those points here, Smithy would have probably been top scorer. Good strike. Creeping. Damn it.
Oh.
I thought he'd nailed that.
What do you think, Connor? I think we should have...
it's a tough kick. But he is capable of kicking up.
Yeah.
It was a tough kick. I'll tell you what, I've taken a bit of stick because every week I mention Smithy's hair because he must have his barber on retainer.
Yeah.
But Exeter have got some Barnets, haven't they? Oh, my God.
They've got the whole works. They've got the long hair, the mallet...
That's what you get down south in the depths of Cornwall.
First touch then. Right, Smithy, first touch. Oh, what a shot. Tell you what, big Andre's felt that. Good quick ball though.
Great kick. Good kick, DC. Lovely stuff.
DC was our first guest on the show and he's... I tell you what, it's a good shot there.
It's a great tackle. I think he was falling, to refer to Andre.
DC says he was entirely responsible for you signing. Has she?
He had nothing to do with it whatsoever.
Oh!
Unlucky.
Challenge on the line out.
Mate.
What?
Oh, because...
get the feeling we could be seeing quite a few penalties.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's always like this when the season kicks off or whatever. Everyone takes a little bit of time to get used to it again. Probably because you get away with these things in training. Don't you? So they forget.
Do you think they should bring refs in like they do?
They do, you know.
We do.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, big Steph. Yeah. Seemed like a very popular decision to make him captain.
Oh, definitely. He's look at yes, Stefan.
Oh, he's nearly pinched that.
That's why.
Yeah. Right then, Exeter probably trying to pick and go from 60 metres out.
Nice beautiful.
They're kicking it from there.
Yeah.
They turned full Saracens mode. You're better than that, Exeter. Yes, Brownie.
Oh, Brownie.
Holy. He's so good.
Yes, Marcus.
Oh, is that going
on? Oh, get good. Get good.
Get down.
Yes.
Smart kick from Marcus. The chase is on as well. Nathan's after that one. Ollie Woodburn is absolutely putting it on.
Was it
Cadero, was it?
Is it? No.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, it was Cadero. You can tell with his running style.
They're really excited about him. They're saying he's raw. Also, tells me that I need an eye test.
Yes, tackle! Nice, Caden. Oh. Let's go. Rush up, boys. Chop him. Nice low day. Lovely low day. Up, up. Here they come. Oh, good damn.
We're going to be bringing up our Green King IPA fan wall soon. We've got the supporters club at home. Oh, they're all on a Zoom call.
Nice.
So if something good happens, we'll be bringing them into it. It's all a bit midfieldy
nice,
at the moment.
It's a great clean out from Exeter.
Yeah.
Because we've had that.
Mate, look at this.
Kick it.
Nice. Yeah. Yes, Brownie! Oh,
They're good at that.
Oh, yeah,
they?
Yeah. Like the inside.
Kick it, boys, kick it. Just get it down there.
Kick it.
He's not left footed, Marcus. He didn't know.
It's all a bit frantic at the moment, isn't it? Simmons.
Nice wheel.
Hits the line hard, Simmons. Because he's not massive for an eight, is he?
No, he's powerful.
Lovely. Really. Who's it?
Oh. There are going to be.
They're going to, how many faces is that?
I was going to say, there are going to be some lads breathing through straws after this. Because it's gone a little bit crazy.
Shot of the system.
Fucking hell of a chop.
That's too
much. They've gone to the kick.
There we go.
That's it, they've had enough of the fun stuff.
Breath! We can't be having this all night.
Well taken by Brownie, though, on the 22.
It's too, even that's too long for me. It's just too long. Go
nice
on,
kick.
Dave.
Nice kick. Hit him.
Fumbled nice that, you know. 10 minutes, we'll be checking in with Rachel. I wonder where she is. She just sneaks around. Hopefully she'll be finding us a good interview.
Yes, I'll...
Yes! Oh, here we go.
Hello.
Good turnover. Who was it? Wilco just stole it with his quad. No hands needed for Wilco. Some of the biggest legs I've ever seen, Wilco.
So we've got the benefit of a replay of this Cordero break. He's got through what... I tell you what, clip that out and show that to Tom Lauday. He's literally like a matador waving him through there. Turnstile arms. Sorry, Tom, don't hurt me. Looking forward to how well Tom does this season, actually. I like him. Well, former employers tonight as well.
Yeah, it's true.
He'll be wanting to put a good show on. Right, are we going to see the ball out of the scrum? Yes, we are.
Crossfield.
One for Caden to chase. Get a bounce.
Go on.
Okay, what?
Ooh. He's a nice little player, Cordero.
Yeah.
Yeah, nice kick there. There we go. Oh, it's Marcus. Marcus, be careful, mate.
Yeah, it's quite frustrating, isn't it? You see an extra team sheet with no Stuart Hogg.
Oh, lovely kick.
Cordero pops up.
Oh, damn it.
Good kick, Vincey. That's two.
Lovely.
Here we go then. Line out, deep in Exeter 22, 0-0.
Some pressure on.
Levis.
What do you reckon, Dex? Front?
Yeah. Middle. Into the middle. So.
Front.
Go on, get hands on that. Here we go. Now, sticks or corner?
Corner.
What? He's got to go sticks. He's got to go sticks.
Turnover. Yeah, got to bang this over.
Is that Santi over the top?
Oh, it was Santi. He didn't even celebrate. He just walked back. It was Wev doing all the celebrating. Probably trying to convince everyone it was him that got the turnover. It was at the prop forward, Santiago.
The humble Santiago.
Great name, Santiago.
Yeah, it is good, isn't it? Yeah.
Might change my name. Santiago Ashton. Won't really work well when I go back to Wigan.
Santi to his mates.
I won't have any mates if I'm called Santiago in Wigan.
I wonder if there are any... Well, they wouldn't be youngsters now, would they? Here we go, then. Oh, 3-0. Thank you very much.
Great.
Nice, Marcus.
Penalty for Harlequins. Scored by number 10, Marcus Smith. That makes the score. Harlequins 3, Exeter Chiefs 0.
Nice, Wilders.
Come on, you Queens.
Just enjoying the beats. I wonder if there are any... They'd be in their sort of 20s now, wouldn't they? From back in the day, like any... Wiganese called like Frano or something like that.
Come on, boys, catch the kickoff. That's you, Simo. Get up.
Go on, Simo. Yes. Safe as houses. Here we go, back at it.
Oh, man, look at that.
What? Oh. That was a triple whistle.
Oh, no.
Oh, negative.
What's happening there?
Because I think it's because he's torn his oblique early in the late in the season. I think, oh, my God, we don't need this. Come on, Simo.
The rib again? Well, his rib?
Yeah, his rib, yeah.
What did you call it?
Oblique.
Is it?
It could be.
That's what he said.
Oh, no, that's that looks leggy, doesn't it?
Oh. Oh, no.
So we've got the benefit of the replay here. Nice, clean catch.
Oh, is this...
Yeah, just a twist on the knee. Exeter player coming through.
I think he's on the landing, to be honest.
Yeah.
Twist inside, not too bad. It's when he landed. He landed like my nan. With a bent knee in. Yeah. You'll be stronger on that land there, Simo.
Has anybody else watching at home got a mental image of Ashley's nan being lifted by a couple of quins from a kickoff? What I haven't mentioned so far is the fact that these guys are going to be here throughout the first half. We've got a couple of other lads joining us in the second half. Who have we got? We've got Campagnaro and Aaron Morris joining us for the second half. Charles Stanley, Ask the Experts is the feature, so get your questions in on Facebook or YouTube. Just put them in the chat box and we'll put some of the best ones to these two. Oh, he doesn't look very comfortable out there, does he?
He looks like that, Simo, sometimes, and then he's all right.
He does it in training.
He does it most days in training.
They come game day.
He'll do anything to get out of training.
How would you describe him as an individual? Looks like a good teammate, Simo. Run through a wall for you.
Tex are no more than me on that.
I mean, Simo is one of my good friends, and I played against him in New Zealand.
Okay.
So he was playing in Canterbury. I was playing for Tasman. So when he had his hair back in New Zealand, so when he came over, I don't know what happened.
Jokes aside, I do actually hope he's all right.
Yes. Yeah. I think it's going to be the end of him today. That's Glenn Young coming on.
Oh, come on, Simo.
He wouldn't come off if he wasn't a...
Yeah, he's a very tough player. Like, I'm going to come off this early. Mm. It's pretty severe because he's one of those hard players that just plays on. I remember when he did his, I think it was PCL, and he played on for 40 minutes. I was calling him, Simo, come out, I need to play. So to call him out, so... Yeah.
Glenn Young's been playing well. He played well back end of last season,
yeah.
Is he?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a good player.
I think he scored against Chiefs in February as well, but I might have made that up, so don't quote me on it.
Is it?
I mean, you did.
No.
It wasn't just you, though.
No, it wasn't.
Well, Young goes straight into the engine room, and we're going to restart with a scrum. Quinn's put in.
It's a big push from Exeter next time. Great idea getting out quick.
Come on. Good carry.
It's a big carry.
Good carry.
Two or three defenders out.
Lovely. Nice Lodi.
Can everyone hear Guzzy just showing offside?
Honestly, it's every time.
He's the only DOR I see shouting offside. Maybe because he's a defence coach too, he gets annoyed at
nice,
offside.
Nice.
There was one game in particular last year, and I'm trying to rack my brains. It was after the restart, and they were offside all the time.
I think it was London Irish. I remember him being exceptionally... London, yeah. Load on the offsides that night. Oh, ref, come on, man. How is that legal?
He's dropping these box kicks into sort of no man's land, though, isn't he? They're like great length on him, and that one's been knocked on.
Yeah.
Okay. So now we know what they're trying to do, right? Come on.
No one wants to see that. I, for the life of me, at the top of this game, I cannot understand why that exists in this sport.
A seven-man.
This doesn't happen often, but the people watching at home, which is the screen of us three watching rugby, is probably about as entertaining as them setting up a seven man.
It's not even a new thing. It's been going on years now. I just don't know why it's not changed.
Rules is rules.
Yeah, hey, that's why they're champions, you know.
Yeah.
They, you know, that's why they're champions. They do things simple.
Yeah.
And they do it well.
Effective. Yeah, effective.
Good scrum, boys.
So now Maunders having a go this time.
Oh my god. Nice Dombren. Oh, here they come. Come on, boys. Come on. Look it.
Little nudging behind. Man. Brownie's on the chase.
What?
That's gone into touch, just tell you what.
Good play for Exeter.
Were we short of numbers there?
Hey?
When they came
on the scrum?
No, like just then.
Yeah, we're slow around the corner,
yeah. Yeah.
Some lads are struggling for breath, I think, mate.
Hey. Oh, and they pinched that as well. Oh, and it's been knocked on. It's been knocked on.
Thank goodness it fell to a prop.
Alec Hepburn and
thank goodness for that.
They've pinched the line out. It has gone straight to him. That is try time, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
Oh, my God.
His terrible lid was probably in his eyes. That's why he missed it.
Oh, it's right in the breadbasket as well.
Lucky. Lucky, lucky, lucky.
Big time.
It's a very good contest from...
Yeah, it is.
Yeah. They read the... Oh.
Never take your eyes off the ball, you see? Big Tex.
Lesson learned. Lesson learned. Now, I'm not saying that is going to be symptomatic of this season, but after rugby restarted, that would categorically have been a try. We were so unlucky with, like, all of those seemed to go against us towards the end of last season. We were talking about the Bath game, weren't we? And, oh, here we go, free kick from the scrum.
What is the point in a free kick there?
Well.
That's another rule I'm not too keen on. What is Marcus just going to do, kick it off and it's Exeter's ball?
Run it. No? Okay, no. Don't.
Yeah. Okay, Exeter's line those 40 metres up.
Good
kick.
Good nudge.
Nice. Nice, Marcus.
Good pressure reliever.
And Glenn Young is one of the best Leonard readers, so...
Oh, so they fancy a front ball here. They've got Dommers there.
So, I'm going to go middle. Into the space there.
Keeping them on their toes, though.
Oh, yes! Yes.
Oh, offside. Penalty. Penalty.
God, I'm sure Guzzi's soaking it. Don't need to worry about that.
but he's got a point there, because that's been knocked on. Yeah, the referee's blown the whistle. The prop's caught it. That should be a penalty.
Only Nigel Owens gives those, funnily enough.
So here we go.
He's a mile in front.
I mean, that's absolutely a penalty.
5 metres in front.
I don't know.
It's a penalty!
It's being replayed on the big screen now. I think we're
watching it.
Yeah, we're going to go.
Must have heard me.
Hey, feel free to chip in. Hey, he's miles off. He's flat. Harry Williams.
Oh, no. Doesn't think so.
What?
I don't know. He's back. I don't know what's going on.
The language from the technical area could be described as colourful. Oh, wow.
He must have watched a different game then. Maybe just checking the score on the football or something like that.
Right, Ben, they're going to set the scrum. Berth's got an interview. I'm not sure who she's with, but...
Which one, Exeter? Oh, come on,
Oh, hang on. We'll come to you in a sec, Berth, because I fancy something good to happen here.
Here we go. Oh, look. Nice, Kelly, look.
Okay.
Nice. Here they come. Chop it, man. Go down.
Oh, Glenn Young getting smashed. Berth, can you hear me?
Very well.
Down.
Oh, you probably can't, because I think I might have muted you. I can't hear you, Berth. If you can hear me, well, I try and fix this. I've knackered it. Berth, what are your thoughts on what you've seen so far? Because, and was that a penalty? You're a lot closer than us.
Well, I think we just got to go with the referee. Definitely the technical blocks weren't too happy, that's for sure. But I think, you know, a really, really good start from Harlequins. They've exerted a lot of pressure, both at set piece. I think Marcus Smith and DC, they're putting the balls in the right area, keeping the pressure on. I think they'll be pretty pleased with the start so far.
Clean that out. Clean him out.
But I can't hear you particularly well. I need to somehow increase your volume, but stick with us.
Here we go.
Oh, Big Tex is about to have an aneurysm next to me. But stick with it. See if you can see if you can catch up with someone down there.
Should we come and use this microphone?
Oh, great offload.
That's lovely work from Andre. Big Andre.
I was trying to hear birthday. I saw Andre absolutely steamroll. Well. Plenty more of that, please.
Oh, that's a penalty. Kelsey, he's losing it up there. He should be commentating on the game. He's doing it from up there. He might as well be here doing it.
The beautiful thing about it as well, because I speak to him before the match, and he's so serene. Like, everything is level, and it's well considered, and, you know, he talks so beautifully about his team, and he's quite methodical about it all. But honestly, he is the exact antithesis of that now.
Oh, come on.
Oh, no!
Oh, that's a great ball, Simmons. He's looking like he's going to go. Oh, he's quick.
Wow. What a try.
That is a hell of a try. Hey. Oh. Eddie Jones should be there. I don't know. That's what the hell, mate?
He's a freak. That's a serious finish.
Yeah. Mate.
Not great defence from us, to be honest. To have a five-man lineout, we've got so many numbers out on the lineout, and they go clean through untouched. And finishes it is not ideal.
Can I give you a pet peeve of mine?
Yeah.
All of the Exeter players in the in-goal area
hugging.
Yeah.
Get off, lads. That should be a penalty at the restart.
There's Max. Huh? Max is there.
Yeah, Max. Yeah,
I didn't know he was in the.
Max, did you remember?
Is he
Max?
On the? Is he in the team?
Is he?
No,
he's extra.
Admittedly, that does sound like sour grapes because they've just scored a screamer of a try. But I just think it's. I mean,
no,
admittedly,
it can be annoying, yeah,
admittedly,
annoying.
Our lads are down there now. I think an easy fix is just make sure that you have to. Warm
I don't
up.
Think it's so bad in that circumstance. But when it bothers me is when there's the other team's players still tackling and then they come in. Yeah, that can be annoying.
Oh, okay.
If that's rugby league, the fighting.
Sometimes it's a leveller, though, you know? Right, then, kick to make it 7-3. Tough one for the right footer.
He's a good kicker.
Yeah. Yes, he is.
Oh, mate, he nailed it.
Oh, 7-3.
Wow.
That's the first chance they've had, other than the sort of knock-on, but...
Oh, that's so frustrating. Shouldn't be happening on such a small line-out. It should not be happening.
Okay, restarts up. Gone over the man. Come on, let's nick that ball back then.
Yes,
come here on. We go. Right then.
Here we go. Come on, boys. Come on, we got this.
I think I've fixed it, so next time I'll be able to hear Berth. So we'll hope to hear from her again before half-time. Maybe rustle up an interview, maybe. Where will Simo be now? Will he have got changed or will he be on the...
Depends how bad it is.
He's probably in the physio room. Okay. Probably have a shower, warm shower, and come on.
Could do with a warm shower, mate. Yeah. I'm absolutely freezing.
It's dropping. It's getting colder,
isn't
it?
Yeah.
Oh, as if Nate's been skinned by some Simmons. I'll be giving him that on Monday. I know that much.
If, after watching that, Sam Simmons is your rugby hero, you will not be winning this shirt.
Might be Nate.
But remember, this is the jersey that you can win. It's the brand new jersey. Strong. As come Esther on, Hazen gets over the game line again. Come back to
in
a second.
Okay.
Right, Dommers. Nice. First carry for him. Remember, he can hit those lines again. Nice. Two of the best eights in the business today. Oh God, Northmore's just been melted. We're about 70 metres away and I just heard that. Oh. But remember, get your rugby heroes in. We'll draw it at the end and you could win this jersey. Plenty more plugs for that too.
Oh, come on, we're close.
Oh, good hands by Brownie. Wasn't the best of passes. And he's managed to stay in field as well.
Come on, Lord. Who's in?
Oh! Oh, tough one.
Knocked on. Advantage coming. I think they're
going
to... Oh, go on, Andre. Oh, this could be trouble.
He's going to kick it. It's a foot race.
You're backing Brownie in a foot race? Oh, he's given up on it. He's letting Marcus chase back.
Good tactic.
Has he missed the man there?
Oh, my God, mate. That's... The boys are...
Great tackle from Simmons.
He's put a couple in. I think it was him that smashed...
Northmore.
That's margins, isn't it? If Andre makes that tackle...
Yeah. Look at the boys underneath, mate. Like,
that's got a great bounce as well.
How many phases down there?
Should have kicked it against Delphatti, right?
Right then. So the water's on. Let's see if we can hear from the water carrier. I'm going to... What was the message?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah. You could be the fucking...
I did do that.
You press that and it comes out there. I wonder what they're talking about.
You know those things that are good ideas in principle?
Graham. He's a wrong gun, that lad. Let's hear some more, please.
Come on, let's have a bit more. Let's have a bit more.
I went to the flight company today and says, right, what's the fucking crack here?
Just listen to that, it's amazing. I couldn't have gone any better.
Come on, boys.
Come on, boys. Get in there. Hit it.
Wait. Nice. Oh,
every time I watch Exeter in this situation, it's like looking into the future.
Don't say that.
No, good God, it's come out. Right, here's Cordero, steps inside, good tackle.
Oh, yes!
Thank you!
It's amazing how both Coderos have got such a similar running style.
He looks like he's going to be a problem in this league, doesn't he? Young Facundo.
Is that genetics or what? Just watching his older brother run. He's got the same step.
Yeah, he does.
Knock on in the 22, bit of a let off. So I'm just seeing Jerry's down there, he's with a water carrier. Do you reckon he'd be any better with the microphone clipped
on? Anyone would be better than G.
He volunteered for it.
Did he? Of course he did. He's probably completely forgotten.
Oh, goodness me.
We should get him on here.
Yeah, definitely. It'd be a good shout.
This is Gallagher Premiership Rugby. This is Harlequins Live. Oh. But if you were offended by the language that you may or may not have heard, then sorry. We're just trying stuff, you know? It's a live show.
Let's try him again. He's in a better spot now. They're chatting rugby, I think.
He's barred. He's barred for the time being. Goodness me.
He reminds me of what's his name of Some Mothers Do Have Him.
Oh, that's a reference.
What is his name?
What's
his name? It's old for me, that is.
What do you know? 13?
33.
Crikey.
Still fast.
Oh, wow.
Still fast. Come on, Thomas.
Oh,
that's no arms.
No way. Yeah, that's Guzzy.
What's the story about the boy who cried wolf? Here's DC taking his time.
Great kick, DC.
He's been good off the shoe tonight.
Great kick. That's a 50-meter kick.
Well, well, well. So we've got 10 minutes till half-time. 7-3. Frustrating to be behind, actually.
Oh, man, this is... Oh, front.
Front's the prediction.
Yeah, and then...
Oh, gone to the...
Oh, look. Oh, nice wheels. Will Evans.
Textbook. Oh. I think a box kick's coming.
It is. Oh, here we go. Here we
go. I can feel it. It's like Phil Collins. Come on, Caden. Get up for this, mate.
A bit deeper this time.
Oh, it's not a nice turn on it.
Oh, good take.
That's a lovely... It's just the wall of white.
Andre Rods, come on.
Oh, he's going to try and tie them in. Sprint! Sprint! Oh, they tie them.
Yeah.
Well done.
Nice, Caden.
Well done. There's a boot flying round.
It's a. This is.
Steph lost his boot.
Oh, he made a tackle with the boot.
The skipper.
The skipper.
Making tackle with no boot on.
Doesn't need a boot. Doesn't need a boot. Another box. Brownie's under this one. That's knock on, isn't it? Knock on white.
Pretty much.
Kick for kick at the minute.
Yeah,
not the most fluid periods we've had. Half an hour in.
It's a good kick. Put him in.
Cordero. Oh, what the hell? This guy is unbelievable.
He's, yeah.
He is unbelievable.
Yeah. Annoyingly good.
Oh, sin. Oh, here we go. Another one. Box kick. Yeah.
This is the seventh kick, I think.
Get back.
Oh, yeah,
well,
no
done.
One.
Good pressure. Their own wing didn't know
look
that.
At, oh,
well done, Luke. Well done, Luke. Well done, Luke. Go on, then.
No.
Yeah.
Stay in, field, mate.
Stay in.
Oh my God!
Oh, here we go.
Can you do that? You can't do that. It's illegal. You can't just throw it off the deck. Oh man! Bit of momentum, bang. Forget it.
What was the right play there then?
I think Luke probably just keep hold of it and we can all clean. I know it's a good offload in the end. Andre just needs to stay over the ball a bit more. We need a bit more support there. Boys aren't reacting quick enough to that kind of thing. It's never on the front foot, it's always on the back foot.
I think he's just panicked there. I mean, all the rugby we've watched in recent weeks and months, there have been so many turnovers, so many penalties for holding on.
Yes! Oh, Domus. That's very, very good from Domus. Good read from Domus.
There are two number eights playing in this game, and I am gobsmacked that they haven't got more England games between them.
Yeah, it's just a shame the amount of good players that England have at the minute in that position.
Especially back rows, And Billy's not...
Yeah, Domus will get there. It's just a matter of time. He just needs to consistently play well, Domus.
Mm-hmm.
And as soon as he gets a chance, I'm sure he'll take it too. It's just hard to get a chance at the minute in that team. Well done, Donald.
Hit him, boys.
Nice. Good read.
There's O'Flaherty coming in looking for work.
Hit him, boys. Here they go. Chop him! Lovely. Here we go. Come on, boys.
Scotty Baldwin making tackles.
Yes! Oh,
big shot.
Lovely shot.
Oh, was that Andre tasty. Putting one on Simmons?
Very tasty.
Oh, here we go.
Here we go.
Alec Hepburn eats it this time.
Here we go. Oh, yes!
Thomas jumps on it.
Why?
What?
Just brain explosions all over the place.
Ay, ay, ay. I mean, we're back in their 22, but scrum advantage, backs on backs. Oh, killing me.
I don't understand why we turn them over, top work, but then Webb decides to pick and go. And then Domus bangs it.
And now we're 50 metres back down the pitch. I'm sure Rachel Burford has got an opinion on that. She's down there. Hopefully I can hear you this time, Berth. That was annoying.
Disappointment. Can you hear me all right this time?
Are you there? Oh, I can. Oh, yes, I can. I can, I can, I can, I can, I can. I found the volume.
Yeah, I think they'd be disappointed with that. That was an
can you
impressive...
Hear me?
I can hear you. Really impressive defensive set, like two huge tackles, hitting Exeter back around the gain line. Shame that we didn't have a bit more composure there.
What are your thoughts on the young fullback in Exeter Chiefs colours this evening? He's been impressing us over here. He looks useful.
Yeah, he does look electric when he gets on the ball. I think, you know, Murley's been doing a really good job, but every time we're putting a ball up, he's under pressure. He's got two players defending him, because I think if you do give him a little bit of space, as we saw down the short side right early on, he's got some wheels and some dancing feet.
Wheels and dancing feet. Right, Berth, stick with us. You're my good luck charm. I think we're going to catch in the second half. You want to come over here and speak to Big Tex, because he is just classic entertainment. He doesn't realise it. But honestly,
I remember he couldn't sit
I'd
still
love
last
to watch
time.
A Fiji game with him. I think it'd be amazing. Yeah. So stick with us, Berth. Always great to hear from you.
Here we go. Come on, Marcus.
Right, good shoe on that this time.
They're waiting for the ball. Oh no! Oh my goodness! I thought he was gonna. Oh my gosh!
You've got a dead leg, mate. Will you chill out? We're gonna need you on the pitch.
Hit him, boy! Yes, Baldus. Oh, that's my boy. That's Baldus. Come on, numbers. Oh my god!
Oh, yes. What a shot!
Who was that?
Northmore.
Look, Northmore.
Northmore. He's just got. Boys. He's just taken Domers' arse straight to the head on the clear out there.
Lovely.
The two archers, boys. It's been physical for old Luke Northmore today, isn't it?
Up it goes.
Good nice. Take, Brownie.
Come on, Nath. Hit him, Nath. Oh, my God.
Oh, oh my goodness. Three tackles he's got through there.
Yeah, he's so slippery. Oh, mate, we've got numbers. We've got shot here. We're shot. Come out.
Oh, Joseph is this
strong, Simmons.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's... Oh, whoa.
Get up, boys.
Get up, yeah. Nice, Baldus. Come on, Baldus. Nice. Just...
Couple of minutes till half-time. Come on. Let's get our hands on the ball. One
Come
good
on,
possession.
Chop him. Lovely. Here we go. Oh, here we go. Another one. The 20th. Box kick on halfway.
Yeah. Nothing's changing.
Caden knows he's got so much time, he's literally strolling back into position. Right then, Brownie calls the mark.
What do you think they're doing that for? Why are they like box kicking from halfway?
Because it's the first game. They don't want to try anything too risky because they're away from home and getting back into it. It's,
okay.
Yeah.
it's not great to look at, but it's very effective.
Yeah.
Especially when they've lost a few, or they've not got key players in at the minute.
Yeah, just keeping it simple.
They go to that sometimes, that style of play.
Yeah. And they back themselves defensively, don't they?
Yeah. They back themselves later in the game, but 60 minutes to start playing and get tries that way.
Yeah. They've done that sneaky line-out a couple of times now. Good shot, Luke Northmore.
Hit him, boy. Hit him, boy. That's my boy. Here they come. Oh, this is set up. Look at this set up again. There we go. Another one.
There's Lorde trying to make a nuisance of himself.
So what we're supposed to be doing is Lorde.
Thank you.
Good catch, Bruno.
It's meant to be holding him, holding them down there. So they, because once they kick, they're all numbers. Chasing.
Oh, Brownie's taken a knock there. That's another one of those landings, isn't it? He's just been touched in the air and just landed heavy on the right leg.
That wasn't like my nan, though. That was getting hit.
No, more like your granddad.
It's a bit of a late leg there for Brownie for me.
What was,
was the Wasp player got?
It was
Paolo Dog.
Who was it in the World Cup? The Dutch fella in the World Cup who kicked the Spanish player in the chest in the Football World Cup now. Just leaves the boot up on the way in.
One of the Wasp players did it last season. He ended up kicking the chaser right in the face. And got a red card.
Well, I'm glad Brownie didn't. Right, clock's in the red. Last chance to get on the ledge.
Come on, Dommers.
There's Dommers. Bit of 8-on-8 violence there as Simmons comes over to make the tackle.
Come on, boys, here we go. Come on.
Here.
Evans.
Don't
see Will Evans ball in hand very often, do we?
Come on, Marcus. Yes, yes, go.
Right,
go
then, Caden.
Make yourself, Caden.
No, stay in.
Yes. Stay. Oh my God.
If they turn that over, Howard, I'm going to have to put a muzzle on you, mate. Stop swearing. It's a family show. Right, that'll be half time. Oh. Damp squib to end it in the end. Harlequins 3, Chiefs 7. Gentlemen, thank you for your company. You're not done yet. Get that headset on. I got you for a couple more minutes yet. Interesting half of rugby. We're back underway. Before I let you go to enjoy the second half in the warmth, your thoughts on what you saw there in the opening 40 minutes, Ashy?
Both teams filling each other out. We've had a good bit of time off, so just trying to get back into the rugby and how they play. Exeter have come with a game plan to kick from high up in the pitch and try and play off set piece. They've scored a nice try off that, so I can't see them going away from that. From Quinn's side, we've not had enough territory to play any sort of rugby in decent positions. We've got turned over in the half, I think, every single time we've been there, so you're not going to beat Exeter doing that. We need to get into the half and play some rugby. That side of it, if we're going to get some points on the board.
And Big Tex, you need to get your heart rate back down to normal after that stressful stuff. What do you want to see, particularly from the forward pack in the second half?
I think just us in general, just keeping the ball. I think it's the first game. I think we need to keep the ball. And when we keep the ball, we're very dangerous. And I think we're giving away too much ball away, I think, from our mistakes. And that's how Exeter are pouncing on us. So I think it's just keep the ball and then stab them the ball, and we can probably score tries from there.
Thank you, boys. Great to have you for the first half. We are underway. It's not just Harlequin's men's team who are getting their season underway. The women are flying. They're 5 wins from 5 at the top of the Allianz Premier 15s. Jess Breach is going great guns, not just for Quinns, but for the Red Rose as well. She's got a great try against France just last week, and I caught up with her earlier today.
Quinns women, what a start you've had to the season. 5 out of 5, top of the league. Bonus points all round. You've got on the score sheet. It doesn't get much better than that, does it?
Yeah, no, it's been a really good start to the season for us. Obviously, having Gerard come in as a new coach, I think it's definitely been beneficial. He's just given us a different outlook and what we want to achieve and how we want to play as a team. But it's been really good. And yeah, to get 5 wins out of 5, I think is fantastic. And, you know, we've got 4 games left until Christmas, but I think, you know, they're probably going to be the hardest games, especially coming out from international. So people might have some niggles or some bumps. But yeah, it's exciting. And, you know, obviously everyone's probably raring to go. And, you know, it's a free weekend for some of the girls that played last weekend. So get rest up and then, yeah, four games to go.
What are you doing with your week off or weekend off?
So obviously going to watch the game tonight. Me and Ellie are going to watch it together because Chloe's in Scotland and obviously Beckett's playing tomorrow. So it's going to be the two of us in the house. And then I'm going to go along to Twickenham and do some social media stuff tomorrow and watch the girls at the stadium. And then probably just rest up on Sunday for a big week ahead. Obviously, I think we've got Gloucester next weekend. So not too busy, but with some rugby involved, so which will be nice.
Just can't get away from rugby. If you're not playing, you're involved. But it feels like a pretty amazing time to be involved at the top level. I mean, we can't have this conversation without mentioning the fact that you were on BBC. I think 800,000 was the peak audience. Yeah. You put your best foot forward by scoring a screamer of a try. That must have been not just an amazing day, but an amazing few days in the build-up and the camp as well.
Yeah, definitely. I think when we first heard that it was going to be on BBC, everyone was like, oh, is it true? Like, is it just like a rumour? But then when we found out that it was actually going to be a thing, I think it's fantastic for the women's game to be able to just people to switch on and just be able to watch it and not have like the hassle to go onto like a live stream or like to actually find it and like be like, oh, can you send me the link? But to actually it be there is amazing. And the feeling in camp last week was really good. Obviously, I think playing France in France is a massive like test for us with or without their crowd, and obviously we came out on the better side. And I think going in at half time we were really, you know, we were knackered, but I think we were confident that we could go out and perform in the second half. And then yeah, getting that try, I think for me like solidified the game, and I think we worked really hard. And obviously hopefully tomorrow they can do the job and, you know, go 3 from 3, including the Italy game.
Because where did you run the try in from? It's about 40 metres, wasn't it? Maybe a bit more than that?
Maybe on the 10. Yeah, I don't know.
At what point did you think, I'm in here?
Well, so if you watch it back, and I think during, Zoe obviously passed me the ball and like she just like shouted like go, and like you can see her like arm like point up. And then like Leanne, and this happens all the time, like when I make a break, she literally like shouts at me, she's like, finish! And I'm like, it like scares me. And so I think that's probably when I hear like Leanne say like finish or like keep going, then like I know that like there's no one else around me or like have the confidence to go. But we like chatted after and Leanne was like, oh, I thought you were gonna run into me.
The shot's great actually on TV if you sort of go in past her as well. I've only seen it from the back where it looks like she's waving you through, but it makes perfect sense that she's shouting at you as well. I could talk to you all afternoon. This is such a good show we put on, and everybody I've spoken to, I could just sort of get a pipe and slippers and really sort of settle in. But we're on Harlequins Live. Have you got a message for the Quins family? Because, of course, we've got the live stream coming up. We're covering the game on the 5th. You're involved with England. It's the World Cup draw as well. Have you got a message for the supporters of not just Harlequins women, but the Harlequins family in general?
Yeah, I just think keep getting behind us. Obviously, like, it's a tough time for everyone and everyone wants to be out there supporting their team and, like, be able to go and watch. But I think it's fantastic, you know, what BT are doing and what we're doing at Harlequins to, you know, have the game streamed live, like men and women, and obviously have this talk along so you can get like the banter maybe that you would have like at the pub or even in the stands like with your friends. So I think it's like fantastic, and just to keep supporting us, and, you know, hopefully one day soon we'll be able to have you back in the crowd and we'll be able to like thank you for keeping supporting us like at home on the sofa.
Before I let you go, I need you to make me a promise that when everyone's allowed back in the ground, you'll come on the show in person?
Yeah, of course. I promise. I pinky promise.
I can't wait. Look after yourself. Have a good weekend.
You, bye.
Bye.
I'm going to hold you to that, Jess. As soon as you are at the Stoop, we're going to be having you as a guest here on Harlequins Live, presented by Silverbug. That is Jess Breach. She is an absolute rock star. If you've not been watching Quins Ladies, they're playing a great brand of rugby. And we are live streaming one of their matches. 5th of December is the date. They're hosting Gloucester Hartbury here at the Stoop. I'll be on commentary. I look forward to you joining me. It is 3-7, Quins trailing at half-time. If you are just tuning in, this is Harlequins Live. I caught up earlier with the chief exec, Laurie Dalrymple. He is full of optimism ahead of a great season. It's always a brilliant chat, a brilliant insight when we talk to him. And with so much going on with Harlequins at the moment, we decided that we just had to get in on show show number one of the new season. Here we go again then. We've been trusted to launch the season, just like we were after the rugby restart and the test event. Something's going well at Harlequins.
Yeah, something is. I think it's testament to who we are as a club. I think it's a really strong ringing endorsement about what we bring, even without any crowds. The delivery, the operational delivery of what we do here at the Stoop is excellent. And if the quality of what we've delivered through restart 1920 is replicated tonight, then we'll have delivered on that faithfulness. And we love playing under the lights. We love being at home. And, we've got the double champions coming. We think it's going to be a cracking game.
The government made a big financial pledge yesterday for lots of sports, but rugby union got over £100 million. Fans want to know, what's that going to mean, not just for Harlequins, but for the wider game as well?
Yeah, and it's a good question. I guess the genuine answer at the minute is we don't know fully, but we have, we spent weeks submitting information through Premiership Rugby into DCMS, and it's gone up to the Treasury. And the news that we got yesterday is very positive, but the devil's in the detail. We'll work through that now. We'll make an additional submission into Sport England, and that financial support that we hope will come through could end up being a vital lifeline for us, as we've previously stated. Elite sports clubs carry huge, heavy costs in terms of their operating costs. We've got to run a professional sports team, we've got to run this stadium, we've got to run our training facility, and those things don't come for cheap. And we've got minimum standards to meet as well, which are governed by the main authorities within this sport. So we've got so much little wriggle room in terms of our cost. And as we've discussed on many occasions, when the revenue model is so restricted, any support we can have is going to be gratefully received. And look, fair play to the government for coming through at the moment with what looks to be a really strong support package for our sport, because we're going to need it.
I take a look around and the Stoop looks incredible tonight. As you mentioned, the lights, we love playing under the lights. We also love having fans here on Friday nights too. Going back to October, how proud are you of what the club managed to pull together when we had those 3,000 Quinn supporters in for that game?
Yeah, we were hugely proud. You're exactly right. We love, I personally have been coming to this ground for many years. I love the night games. You look at some of the most momentous sort of results we've had under the light. So it's another game where we've not got the supporters in. We understand why. We'll continue to be patient, but equally we'll continue to lobby. And as you rightly say, we delivered the event that seems ages ago now, back in September. Things have changed again significantly, but what we did and what we produced and delivered on that day, from a operational perspective, was remarkable. And we've had ringing endorsements from Public Health England, from the local authorities here, that sort of qualified that the event was a success. There was absolutely no increase in COVID contractions as a result of that at the time, and I appreciate we're in a slightly different landscape now, but we've proven that we can do it safely and securely, and we've proven that there is a real interest from the fans, that they want to come back in. We're desperate to connect with our fan base again, not just through digital and social channels, but through live delivery of sport.
So much going on, but I saw you tweeted about the new third kit yesterday and that you love everything about it. Talk to us about that, because it looks exciting.
It's fantastic, isn't it? And it's, I guess these are one of the reasons why you partner with big global brands like Adidas, because you want to have a point of difference. And I've personally worked with Adidas for, well, pre-Harlequins and before, and then obviously here. So some of the initiatives that they do are fantastic. This is one of them. It's about sustainability. It's about addressing a major global problem around sustainability. And so we were only too happy to be a beneficiary of that and to try and shine a focus on that. The kit itself, I think, is fantastic, and that's my opinion, but and I know these things can be really subjective. It's not the quarters, and we'll be in the quarters plenty through the season, but it's, as I say, it's an opportunity for us to shine a bit of a positive light on something that needs to be in our focus. And the content that was created in partnership with Lovell and the guys here, to shoot it at a time when we're so restricted in what we can do, I thought was fantastic, and the feedback's been brilliant.
I think it's important to highlight the firsts as well. So the first club to have that sustainable jersey, the first club club to have that partnership with a charity like Movember, mm-hmm. the first club to have fans in, the first club who are back out in front of the cameras. When we welcome the supporters back, I think it's important that everybody realises that as a club, Harlequins are always trying to do the next great thing for the players, for the fans, for the club.
100%. And even in these difficult times, we're still challenging the team to provide the best content that we can, to find the best level of engagement, to keep our fans connected and supported with us. So it's incredibly difficult, and we've got so many fans that have continued to commit their memberships for next year in times of uncertainty. And as I say, we hope that we will get the fans back in the stadium at some point through this season. But the fact that they've committed that to us, we've communicated how we can support that sort of process for them if they can't come to, or we don't end up fulfilling their sort of their membership obligations. But at the moment, everyone's staying absolutely 100% squarely behind us, and that's absolutely brilliant, and it's a huge support for us. We're hugely appreciative of it, and that transmits itself as well, hopefully positively, into the team.
But it is a rugby club after all, and the pitch is right next to you there. How much do you look forward to the match days and watching the boys run out there and do a good job for Harlequins on a Friday night?
Usually, we're all fans, just like everybody else. You work here and you work in professional sport, you get so ingrained in it that and these are the big games you look forward to, the first ones of the season. And when you sort of, not 2-3 weeks ago, our opposition were picking up silverware, 2 weekends in a row. So these are the weekends that you want to test yourself and play against the best in the league. And as I say, yeah, it's a fantastic feeling. I've got every confidence the team are going to put in a big shift tonight, and really looking forward to it.
Thanks, Laurie. Enjoy the evening.
Will do.
First game of the season, and I have cracked. The gloves are on. I'm layered up. I'm going to look like the Michelin man come the end of the season, come the next match. We've got two new special guests, returning friends of the show. McKelly, Aaron, great to have you boys on board. We're all in. The theme this evening is rugby heroes. We are giving away this, the third shirt. Unfortunately, as you lads are going to be wearing it at some point in the season, you can't win the prize. But people have got to get in touch with us on Facebook and YouTube and tell us who their rugby heroes are. So starting with you, rugby hero.
Michele Campagnaro.
Liar.
I think, so I was 8 years old, 2003, so it's hard to look past them guys, really.
God, you are young, aren't you?
So, yeah, Johnny Wilkinson, Jason Robinson especially.
Ashies was Jason Robinson, you know?
I'll go Johnny then, yeah. It don't get much better than dropping a goal to win a World Cup final off your wrong foot, does it? So.
When I don't want to embarrass myself in front of the Quinn supporters, I will tell you where I was when England won the World Cup in 2003. And rugby heroes?
For me, I think it's probably Brian Driscoll, just because obviously he's in my position as well, and he's one of the all-time legends, and he's great.
Yeah, he was all right, wasn't he? So we've got two here. We've got Johnny Wilkinson, Brian O'Driscoll. Remember, keep your rugby heroes coming in and you could be winning this jersey. Underway then. Simmons Joe getting us underway in the second half. What were you boys' thoughts on what we saw in the first 40 minutes?
Probably was a bit of a turgid affair, a lot of kicking, but it's something you're going to see with the season starting in November. It's not going to be like some of the more free-flowing rugby. Lot of battle around the halfway line to
nice take
to get territory and a lot of box kicking. I think Quinns have defended multi-phase fantastically well. I think our D's look great, and then it's just about whether we can have that little sharp edge in the attack and then shore up that first phase D where Simmons scored.
How are you guys doing physically? How's the knee for you?
He's better. Almost back training with the boys, so hopefully it won't be too long now until I'll be training fully and hopefully be fit for selection again.
People ask after you a lot, they're looking forward to seeing you back in the quarters.
Hopefully by the end of December I'll be there, but let's fingers crossed.
And Aaron, you ready to go?
Not quite yet. Had a little knock to my Achilles in pre-season,
Whose fault was it?
Pardon?
Whose fault was it?
No one's, but okay. Mine probably, and rugby's. So yeah, I'm probably out for three or four more weeks. I'm aiming to be back around Gloucester or Munster.
Oh, nice. Munster, incidentally, the first time the club will wear that jersey. Almost like that was a seamless link. Oh, here you go. That's been knocked back in. Did you guys watch the first half from the bench? Were you over there in the red zone?
Yeah, just behind.
What's the crack with Simo?
I don't know.
Oh, you don't know? Okay.
Yeah. I think they said me, but no idea on severity.
Yeah, it's just a naughty landing, it looked like.
Did it?
Yeah, well, it was from the restart, and he sort of landed straight-legged, and then a defender came in, but we were wondering what the immediate thing was, what they think it might be. Fingers crossed, nothing too bad.
Yeah, he'll be a big loss for us today, and if he's got a spell on the sidelines, because I think everyone would say he's probably been one of our players that have really shone this last year or two, just so much work rate and physicality, and really puts us on the front foot.
He's the kind of player that every squad needs, isn't he?
He just kind of do that, obviously, the dirty work that not a lot of people can see, but like in every ruck he's there, and you know, he's like, he's just caring hard, and like on every line, on every mole, he's just a hard worker, so like, yeah.
But annoyingly,
you see that I don't understand scrum actually, it's just like 50-50 every time.
Yeah,
it's very no up idea.
The amount the amount of rugby that I either turn up to commentate on or do this show, I'd love to know as a percentage how many of the lads actually know what's going on when the referee...
I don't think the props know.
No.
The props just say it's obviously not them.
But even the referee, I don't think he knows. He just like goes with the flow, really.
Yeah, tough.
Well, it's frustrating when the penalty's there as well, because all of a sudden they kicked a touch and... I'm not trying to paint Exeter into a corner or anything, but they quite like having lineouts in the opponent's 22.
Yeah, I think this could be a maul, couldn't it?
Oh, it's been overthrown! Oh,
chugger, man, come on.
Someone get on that. Oh, that's a let-off. Still a long way up the park from there, but a let-off nonetheless. DC's kicked well so far tonight.
Yeah, fantastically. Had it on a string that first 20 minutes, didn't he? Okay,
that's a good take. Now then, big play in defence. Why is Santi looking at the referee as if he wasn't lying all over that then?
It's his second language.
Back where we started. I don't think we're going to be led off quite so easily this time. Come on.
A silly penalty, unfortunately.
Yes. Okay. Been led off once. 7 metres out. Uh-oh. Brace yourself. Oh, crikey. Well, they won't score an easier try like that all season, will they?
Try for Exeter Chiefs.
Well,
not the best start of the second half.
No. Was that Ewers, was it? He has absolutely strolled through this.
We totally missed it, didn't we?
Yeah, frustrating. Frustrating after they've let us off first time round.
Yeah, and that's what we talked about against these lot. Your discipline in that middle third is everything, because what they're going to keep the ball loads in the middle of the pitch, and if you're ill-disciplined, then they're kicking to the corner, and it's either a maul where they're really dangerous, or they'll get into their pick-and-go game where they're the best in Europe. So it's so key that we tighten up our discipline in that middle bit of the pitch.
Right, conversion then, to stretch the lead. Something they've done particularly well, we've not had a try-scoring opportunity in, 46 minutes of rugby now, have we?
No, we haven't. Haven't kept the ball well enough.
Missed the conversion. All right. We can work with that. 3:12. Changes in the front row. Jack Musk and Simon Kerrod coming on.
Nah, Jordan Ells is on.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
I do need my eyes tested.
Two props.
That's twice tonight. A good chase by Nath to make the tackle from the restart. Ells and Kerrod, sorry.
Yes!
Here we go.
Very good.
Like Kerrod, straight on.
Straight in. Right, corner or sticks?
What's the score?
3:12.
Yeah, probably sticks.
Yeah, points.
Uh-oh. Corner.
Yeah.
Good call.
Well, you wouldn't?
I think, yeah, we just need that. We just need to build some confidence through phases, through put them under pressure for a little while, and hopefully just score and get some points.
Well, you wouldn't have blamed them for going for the posts. Need this ball though, Lavis at the front. Well done, Big Steph. Exeter have defended that well to begin with, but now it starts to go forward.
I see Big Andre coming. There you go.
Oh, it's a good tackle on him though. Oh, yes, Lukey Northmore!
Yes. Crossing.
They've even put the flames on. DC doesn't like it. Luke. Him and Domers were very close, I'll say that. Oh, God. Is Ridley going to have a look at this? I'd like him to.
I think he would.
No, not going to have a look at it. Oh, that's annoying. Lovely ball from DC. We've got the benefit of the replay here. So, Big Andre goes through.
Oh, yeah, it is.
Yeah.
Is it, though? Because he still made the tackle. So, Domers has got right through there. He's gone straight through.
It's annoying because he wouldn't have tackled him. Joe Simmons would not have tackled Luke, though.
No, and Witten committed to Northmore. Ugh.
That's not straight.
No, it's not straight. That's right down our... Well.
Hit him.
Disappointing. And do you know what? It's easy to say should have gone for the sticks, but that's just one of those things, isn't it? Good take.
Good take.
And that's high. He's run. It's round his neck.
See, I think now is where we need to get through phases. We need to build our confidence.
That's a second one. Am I misinterpreting the rules here?
Or
if he's got a forearm around his neck, that's a penalty.
Go get it, Lukey. Go get it. Go on, Cade. What's the ball? Yeah, that's us.
Yeah, here we go then.
Oh, take off.
Did you guys see the shot on Northmore in the 22 in the first half?
There was the sound.
Oh, my goodness me. Get a bounce.
Scrum. Give us a scrum.
Good chase, Nate.
Get on ball, Lordy. Yes, sir! Hold him! You tried.
Maybe on the man, not the ball. Meh. Seen him given. Good chase on Nath, though. It's not entertaining rugby, is it? Brownie having a look.
There you go now. Come on, Domus.
High again. Maybe I'm looking at it through a Quinn's lens, but we've got to get one. Here we go. Get under this then. A bit too much on that one, maybe.
Knock on.
Oh, he has. That's the golden boy, Facundo.
Yeah, he was unreal first half.
Well, I wasn't going to say anything because you don't like it when I talk about other fullbacks. Stop!
He's not English, so it's all Gucci.
Okay.
I think he just got back cramps there. He can't even move. And he's like 5 minutes, he's trying to get rid of them. Poor boy.
I listened to Rob Baxter talk about him a couple of days ago, actually, and he's like, he's raw, but he's good.
Yeah, it's just like he's very similar to Santiago, yeah. His brother, his yeah. older brother. I don't know if he's genetic or something, but very good step.
He's walking at the moment like he doesn't have a kneecap. Oh my goodness me. One of you. Well, I'm Brownie.
Put it on 10. Put it on 10.
Get a bounce, get a bounce, get a bounce. Yeah. Joe Simmons has launched that. Nice reminder for you that if you are watching and you are a member, then you can enter the code QuinsChiefs150 to get 150 points to do with as you please. There it is on the bottom of your screen right now, QuinsChiefs150. And if you haven't already, if you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, then make sure you let us know your rugby hero. We will enter it into the draw and you could be leaving with this, the third strip that we might see Aaron in come the 20th of December against Munster. I'm buzzing for those European games, you know.
Yeah, just a shame there's no fans. Yeah. Toman Park with some place to play, everyone says. So.
Patience. Yeah. Patience is a virtue.
Coming onto the pitch, number 23, Tom Hendrickson. He replaces number 50, Findo Cordero.
Hendrickson coming on. Looks like a tall Lord Farquaad, doesn't he?
They move Tom O'Flaherty to 15.
Yeah.
He hasn't played that much.
Stop
them. Who's coming through to spoil
that? Just drop on that. Yeah,
Baldwin,
that's our scrum.
Baldwin,
our scrum.
Baldwin. No.
Oh, I think it was a tackle. You can't do it.
Hey.
Chop, man, chop.
Just grinding to a halt a little bit. Discipline massive here.
Box kick coming.
What on earth would give you that idea? Caden under that.
Oh, well done, Caden.
Good feet, good feet.
Chug? Hot now?
No, another kick.
Yeah, chips on.
Thomas wants, get a bounce. Yes. Oh, he's gone again. And he's been pulled back. Have a look at that, ref.
Banging, 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 banging.
Yes, DC.
Yes, DC.
Thomas, that's his second kick tonight. I'm keeping a tally. The first one deserved a fine, but
I need someone else back.
Brownie getting agitated there. All of a sudden, Holden? He had 70 metres of pitch to cover. Oh, he turned that over. Go on, DC. Oh, come on. Let's look on the bright side, boys. Bit of territory. Will Evans.
Well, they ain't happy with that.
Yeah, Will Evans is furious about that.
He didn't get any turnover today. I think he's very frustrating. And
yeah.
We've got to look at this. So he's on his feet, he's on his feet, he's on his feet, he's on his feet. He's turned the ball over, yeah.
Yeah, I think that was all legal.
I think he's quite hard done by there, Will. That's a smart nudge. Look at that. Do you see that little pullback on Domas there? I'm not sure he'd have won the foot race anyway, but... Hey. Change for Exeter. Is that Ben Moon?
Tyrone's on as well.
Oh, there we go.
How's he settled in, Tyrone?
He's a lovely lad. He's a real good lad. And from what I've seen on training, he's been doing great. Settled in like a charm. Gets on with everyone. Top boy.
Yeah, I haven't had the chance to, obviously, train with him yet. But, he's a very good guy.
Loves anime.
Does he?
Loves it.
There we go.
Him and Nath were bonding over it.
So, is that a straight swap? Do you think he's going to go onto the right wing here?
Yeah, penalty.
Oh, God.
Oh,
Harlequins 3, Exeter Chiefs 12.
Oh, my more defence coming up.
Oh, just mistouch, just do us something. Do you think people listen to this? Obviously, it's only Harlequins fans listening, but do you reckon this is like listening to Fox News coverage of the US presidential
that
election?
Bias. No, because we're not a bunch of idiots.
Oh, right, boys.
And if that offends you, turn off.
If that offends you, good. Right, they've won the line-out. Let's make it a bit more difficult for them this time. Come on, you Quins. Oh, it's creaking. It's edging towards the line.
No, good.
Yep, there you go.
Yeah, go on.
Second win there.
A little bit of sideways. They've got a penalty advantage coming, which is exactly what we wanted, said no one ever. What is Scotty Baldwin doing there? He wants to be careful because he'll get binned.
Are you gonna?
Oh, hello. Go on, reverse the penalty. Go on, Christoph, for the lads. Sam Simmons hasn't made any friends in the Harlequins ranks with that try celebration. It's quite a lot, that was, wasn't it? Oh, they've gone quickly here. Here we go.
It's a speciality at the moment.
Pick and go and pick and go is Kirsten.
There you go, Webb. That's holding. That is holding.
Yes, you got it.
Yes, boys. Will Evans. He's a player, mate. He's a player.
He's so good.
Don't let it go behind our line.
Oh, this exit's horrible.
Get rid of that, Deese.
That's the thing, you turn it over, but it's not a hell of a lot you can do here, is there?
Go long.
Go on, go on, go on, go, 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 go.
That's a good kick.
Great kick. Yeah, that celebration is bad in front of a full stadium where you're doing it to some fans, but when you're doing it to an empty stand...
No one comes out of that looking good, do they?
I think, you know what? I think there is the camera there. That's why you probably did it, but...
But, you know...
We've been mean to your friend.
No, look, lads...
I don't know, I'm just saying.
We all rate Sam Simmons, like, serious...
Oh, he's amazing.
Serious player. So, like, serious player. And that was a quality try, great finish.
Yeah,
but nobody's looked at that and thought, Sam Simmons, great bloke. Anyway, before I dig myself deeper with one of the best players in the Gallagher Premiership,
get more controversial as the minutes get on.
Let's hear from one of the best players in the Allianz Premier 15s, Rachel Burfords. Where are you, Rach? You still down there making friends on your own in the red seats?
Yeah, I'm trying to get closer to that bench, hear what's going on, but they're not letting me in. There's a big tightrope in between it.
What can you hear down there, if anything?
Oh, you can mainly just hear the boys trying to get behind them. You know, they're cheering them on when they get some good hits in, getting some good possession. Like you can hear now, getting really stuck in or, you know, when they're getting pushed back into their own 22, you know, still trying to jeer them up. Hearing a lot from the staff up the top as well. Not happy with the offside, but so it seems.
Oh, if I hear Gussie shout offside one more time, although I'm aware that I probably shouted that loud enough for him to hear me, and he's one fella I don't want to get a rollicking off. Right, what are we on now? 20 minutes to go. The obvious thing for my untrained eye is that Quins desperately need some territory. What do you want to see from them, Rach?
Yeah, I think it's just, you know, they're getting themselves into some really good position. Their defensive sets have been outstanding. And then, you know, it's the ill discipline that's let them down slightly. I'd like to see a little bit more ball in hand. Put a bit of a dent into the extra side and try and get them quickly on the fold. Play a little bit faster. And I'd like to see Domers just carry the ball a bit more instead of kicking it.
That is two kicks for Domers. I've put them both in the ledger, as I said before. Stick with us, Rach. Great to hear from you. We'll check in again before full-time. Hopefully,
cheers.
We'll have a try or two to celebrate.
Great carry, Lorda. So they're short.
Oh, grey line.
Has that gone backwards? Thank you. Oh, and an advantage. Now then, let's do something with this ball. 20 minutes to go. If you've not got your entry in yet, why not let us know your rugby hero? Put it in the chat feature, whatever you're watching on, whether it is the YouTube or the YouTube. How old do I sound?
it's Facebook.
Whether it's the YouTube or the Facebook, get your rugby heroes in. Right, let's give it a second chance. Let's have a listen to the mic that we've got on one of the water carriers. It didn't go very well last time. In fact, I'm not even gonna go for it. You lads won't have heard it. We've got a mic on G down there. And
Graham.
Yeah.
Please turn it off.
You're not from Ofcom, are you? Honestly, like there were more words beginning with F than beginning with any other.
They say you get very passionate about it.
Yeah, exactly. And it was just after Sam Simmons had scored. So you and Sam Simmons, you big buddies, yeah?
He's an ex-chief.
So no. They're always boys. Yeah. I just obviously played there for 3 years, yeah. Which is, you know, you get close with, you know, everyone.
Everyone? Surely not everyone.
Yeah.
All right.
In fairness, I think as teams in the Prem go, they're a very likeable bunch.
Yeah, definitely.
And I was happy for them when I was watching that game against Racing. I wanted them to do business.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't think anybody other than the Racing boys will have begrudged them that victory. Yeah.
I think we're going to get 8-9 right here.
Yeah.
Prediction.
8-9, which side?
To the right.
You don't get 8-9 left, do you? Well, you've changed.
Jersey,
he's been out the game a little while, mate. Leave him alone.
I did.
Yeah.
But you do go on both sides.
How are you feeling about coming back? Nervous, excited?
Very excited, but also be nervous. I guess more you get, you know, close to coming back, more you get a bit more nervous. Mm-hmm. But I think once you back on the pitch and, you know, you don't really think about it.
Yeah, I suppose it'll all build up to a point, then the whistle goes and you're a rugby player again. And
yeah, and obviously we'll take a few games and, you know, a few weeks to get used to again and everything, but, you know, that's part of the game.
I'm excited for you, mate. I can't wait. There's Northmore tackle behind the gain line. Now we go to the toe. Split them. Oh, Witten's underneath that. He's read that well. Oh, nice take, Marcus. God, look at that chase from Ian Witten. Rolling back the years.
Still offside.
Good tackle.
Yeah, go on, Thomas. Go on, Thomas.
Thomas is over that.
Yes!
Yes. Thank you.
Very good.
Like a barnacle. Go on, Thomas.
Shot from Andre there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When you've got a run-up like that, why would you pick him out?
I think often you don't pick someone. Oh, I've had a few where I step and I think there's going to be space and there's just someone there.
You don't want to be there.
120-kilo South African unit.
Yes, Archie!
Sorry, what were you saying about Chris Ashton? They were saying first half.
Oh, what about Chris Ashton? He was a joy to have. I hope we get him on the show again. He was saying that he was getting very frustrated with Exeter's box kicks.
Mm.
He does not like that. He's like, it's not rugby. I don't like it.
Well, he comes from Saracens. They're all.
That Lorde come off. Oh, go on. That's a good chop on Andre, isn't it? That's all you've got to do to him.
Yeah.
And they've turned the ball over. Yeah, if you go
well
high.
Well done, Arch.
If you go high, you're dead.
There you go. I'm excited to see Archie White. He's done very well in training. He's always he's been a guy that really won, you know, to show what he can offer to this game, and hopefully now he can do that.
Well, he's got 15 minutes.
Go on, Cades.
Ooh. Oh. Ooh. Ooh.
45 off that.
Yeah.
Drag it.
Oh, shot.
Go on, Chug.
Why is he called Chug?
I can't tell you. He told us the story on his first day and
okay.
It ain't fit for...
That's for the Harlequins Live After Dark, is it? Yeah, sometimes it's best not to ask. Although I do look forward to finding out at some point.
Get up, Ty.
That's gone back. Go on, Ty. Just won a 50-50. Right, Brownie's got some covering to do here.
Get it.
He's there. Good hands. Let's put the boot on that straight away. Good yards on it. But that is a tired chase from us there. Oh, here we go.
Oh.
Uh-oh.
Yes,
oh, what a tackle. Is that Baldwin chasing back?
Fair play to
come
him.
Come on, Scotty Baldwin. Always trust the Welsh. Oh, come on.
No need.
Oh, Dom.
Yeah, a bit flat-footed. Scott Baldwin, though, try saver. Has DC seen an opening there, or is that just a rush of blood?
What did he do? I didn't see.
Just smashed the nine, but
oh,
I think it was.
The pen, yeah.
It's always 50-50, really, but. If you obviously touch a nine, is what you get.
And Exeter love this. Oh, they've overthrown that though. Go on, Thomas.
Bang it, Luke.
Good left shoe. Go on. Go.
That's a good kick.
Oh, it's only good if you make the tackle. Whoa. He chased his own kick there, Luke, to be fair. Ties back on his own here.
Come across.
And the box kick. Brownie's underneath it.
Brownie's been so good. Hey, he's just solid.
He has been.
Okay. I thought you were biting in there. What are you doing? I mean, I was obviously serious. Just trying to put some pressure in.
Does Brownie fall into the category of English 15s that you hate as well?
No, of course not. I said one thing when you... and you.
No, you're allowed, mate. You want to play rugby. Oh, no!
No, there's...
Why have you done that? Oh, that's a good nudge as well. Advantage over. Go on, Ty. Is there going to be further action here? That was Steph, wasn't it?
Oh.
Annoying as well, because he was covered. It was Northmore had him, was lining him up, wasn't it? No, sorry, it was Caden. All those young lads with floppy hair, they look the same from a certain distance, don't they?
Taps coming on.
Who's he coming on for?
Well, I don't know, because he's covering 10.
He's covering everything,
yeah.
Really.
Yeah.
But I think he's, Lukey.
Oh, Lukey, yeah.
Yeah.
Luke, to be honest, he's been touching his hamstring for a little while.
Yeah, I've seen that.
He's done all right tonight, Luke, he has. He's made some great tackles.
Physical.
Yeah, he's very physical, very solid. You don't want to risk an injury, you know, at the first game of the
season.
Game
one. unlucky with a try as well. That could have put a real different reflection on this game.
Yeah, it would have been 12-10.
Come on, boys, let's see this through here. Big defensive set. Some words from the management there for Lukey, but another 70-odd, well, nearly 70 minutes in the column for him. It was Hendrickson, came on for Cordero, who looked like cramp. We haven't got any news that it's anything more sinister than that. But a very impressive opening to Premiership Rugby for him. Yeah, make the tackles, boys, come on. We've played too much rugby here, haven't we?
Oh, great shot. Who's that? That chugger?
Chug. I can't call him that because I don't know why he's called that. Here we go. Oh, come on, Brownie. Go on, Brownie, have a look. Oh, you are joking. So what has happened here? The ball's been knocked on. Great shot. And then Brownie's gone. Yeah, no options. He did the right thing holding on, but he's left the ball there. Who's oh, yeah, it's gone forward off DC, isn't it? Ugh. He likes that sort of put his head down and go from deep, Brownie, doesn't he?
Yeah, it reminds me of that Saints try.
Yes, yeah.
That Northampton. Ashley scored.
No. Yeah, Northampton, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that's it's quite symptomatic of the game, really, isn't it? Just not being able to get momentum, go through the phases. Big Tom Price coming on for Exeter. He is big as well. Oy, oy, oy. So we've not got a home league game after this till Boxing Day, have we?
Really?
We've got Munster at home on the 20th. Merry Christmas, lads. Game on the 20th. Game on the 26th.
Wow.
Game on New Year's Day. Will you train on Christmas Day?
Nah.
I've
never done it. I've trained on Christmas, Eve, trained on Boxing Day.
Yeah.
Never.
So you don't think you don't think Gezi will call the boys in?
No, we'll just have a team run on Christmas Eve.
Okay. Oh.
Ugh. So what would you do now if you were Exeter? Would you go for the 3 point or would you go for the...
No, I think I'd try and score a third try.
Yeah. I'm not sure 3 points, because 3 points doesn't take them above a threshold, does it? Like, they don't go two converted scores ahead by 3 points. And, oh, that's such a good kick. Such a good kick. Come on, boys, give us something to be cheerful about.
I was just thinking, it's frustrating because energy-wise, physicality-wise, we've been there.
Yeah.
Last time I came on this was that Bath game where we didn't show up, we just didn't play well.
Don't.
But this one has just been small.
Come on, boys, come on. Sam Simmons making friends again.
Just small margins and then discipline, hasn't it?
Yeah.
I saw a graphic came up on the BT thing that we had 9 penalties at like 45, 50 minutes. So we've got to think we're probably on 15 now. You're not going to beat the double champions if you're giving them that kind of field position.
Yeah, and also, like, you know, the times that we've been in there, 22, are not very, are not many. And, like, we need to play there, we need to, you know, play in this part of the of the pitch if we want to obviously score a point and make it more challenging. Otherwise, you know, we're always going to be on the back foot, we're always going to be, you know, kicking and chasing them.
Yeah.
think the manner with which we've conceded this evening is a little bit frustrating as well.
Two driving moves and a first phase try.
Yeah. Yeah.
All feel like they're in our control. It's not like we've been broken down in multi-phase. But
successful conversion added. That takes the score to Harlequins 3, Exeter Chiefs 19.
Just checking the old messages to see if we've had anything in. Oh, we've got plenty of people giving us their players, their favourite players, their rugby heroes. Ollie Claus on YouTube, he says Chris Robshaw. I mean, I understand that Robshaw might be your best player, your favourite player, your rugby hero, but you're not getting any favourability in the shirt draw because of that. Tor Ealing, her favourite player is Oh, what a take that is. That
Not
Browning. Well, her favourite player is Angry Mike Brown. I mean, Angry Mike Brown and non-Angry Mike Brown are two very different players. And Stuart Thomas is coming with Jason Leonard as well. So keep those coming in. Three quins. Doesn't have to be a quin. In fact,
See, the space now is outside. Give it to...
Here's Brownie. None of our quins players have chosen Harlequins as their rugby hero, which is interesting.
Great carry.
Oh, that's a good shot on Scott Baldwin. Wow. Oh, got Cowan Dickey on him. How have they turned that over? Ugh.
Because...
I mean, hats off to Chiefs. In a game that hasn't set the world on fire by any stretch of the imagination, they're just a quality outfit, aren't they? They're just a good side.
I think they just do the simple thing very well. They have patience to go through phases. They don't get bored to do the same things. And you know, obviously they also are like unbelievable in the set piece. So that's what, you know, like end of the day will bring the result and make you win games.
Well, they're going to be sniffing around a bonus point now as well because they've got another penalty. Picture of Domers there, just walking back. He looks a bit deflated, doesn't he?
That kick wasn't the best, unfortunately. Hey, Aaron.
What's the right play there? Where would you have wanted that kick to go?
I saw his space. He just hit it thin, didn't just hit it well.
Yeah, but that happens. Even just have the patience probably to, like, you know, organise and exit properly. I don't know.
Yeah.
Right, come on, boys. Not again. Big effort. Oh, it just feels like Groundhog Day, doesn't it? They've got such good discipline. Simmons with it at the back. He's sniffing around a hat trick. Oh, he's going to get it as well.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
They play deep, don't they? They play late. Their conditioning so good.
Try for Exeter Chiefs, scored by number 8.
There he is, celebrating again, making friends. Sam Simmons, hat trick. Boys, this seems like a strange thing to talk about now, but you're in charge of selecting the DHL moment that delivers. So you're standout moment from this match, from a Harlequins perspective, it can be anything. And as we're watching replays of the bonus point try for Exeter Chiefs, I understand that that might be a bit of a tough ask at the moment, but have a think about it. We've got a couple of minutes. Exeter Chiefs pick up where they left off. Couple of minutes to go then while they kick the conversion. Let's get some input from the Queen of the Stoop, Rachel Burford. I was hoping we'd come to you, Rach, with better news at a better time, but it's not a great time and it's not great news. So how are you going over there?
Yeah, I think just as you mentioned, quite disappointing. I think the reflection of 24-3, you know, makes it as if this game was a lot easier than it was. I think the effort's been outstanding from Harlequins. It's just a shame that let two tries in the last 10 minutes doesn't really reflect the effort and the work rate that they put in.
No, it doesn't. And Exeter are so disciplined. We know exactly what they offer, we know exactly what they do, and I suppose when you've got that ready-made game plan, starting a season is easy, isn't it? You just pick up where you left off. A little bit more difficult for Harlequins, where they're still trying to find that game plan, still trying to find that identity.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, you're not seeing much different from what Chiefs did last season. They execute really well when they get into the red zone, and I think, you know, our discipline allowed them to get into that area and then allowed them to execute something that, you know, they're the best in Europe and the best in England at doing. It's picking and going, really strong driving maul that's been unstoppable tonight, as we've seen. But look, the boys will learn a lot from it, I'm sure.
Well, I hope so. Thank you very much, Rach. Great to hear from you tonight. Great to have you on board, as always. Enjoy the rest of your weekend off. You don't get them very often, so put your feet up and charge the batteries ahead of... What's the next one? Gloucester, Hartbury on the 5th, or have you got one before that?
We've got game next weekend. That's Gloucester, Hartbury next weekend, so we're pretty excited for that one.
It is. It is, absolutely. Well, good luck with that. And then we've got Bristol Bears with the cameras, then you've got Saracens, it's all going on. Anyway, Rach, I will let you enjoy the rest of your evening. Oh, not again. Take my eyes off the game for 2 seconds and Exeter are back in the 22. Just turning the screw. They're going to do this to a lot of teams this season though, aren't they?
It's just their style, really. Yeah, I think, you know, we can obviously learn from our mistakes and obviously learn from what they do well once you recognise, you know...
If they go hot here, in trouble. Walking in.
Oh, good tackle. Really good tackle.
From Kate.
Caden.
Got Archie White waiting there to smash someone. Oh, you've got to think, though, like we're all pretty deflated now, but for a long period in this second half, we were still quite up for this. The scoreline is horrible, but there are crumbs of comfort here. No?
It's just tough, really. Like, obviously, once... I think, you know, after they scored the second try, whatever, we kind of mentally just, you know, lost a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, I think it's just, a game is obviously 80 minutes and you need to be focused on for 80 minutes. You can't really, you know, perform 40 or 60. That's when, obviously, you're going to get a result.
31-3. Pretty depressing. Alas, it's a long season, and I'm sure we're going to have plenty of highs here at the Stoop. Boys, man. Right, conversion then to make it 33. No, not our night. Not our night at all. Do stick with us afterwards, though. I'm going to be getting the final thoughts of these two gentlemen. They're heading pitch side and hopefully hearing from a couple of players and maybe a coach or two. The post-mortem. I'm not sure they'll want to chat to me, but some interviews are easier than others, lads, I'll tell you that. To make it 33-3 here at the Stoop. Which he does, good kick. And the clock's red, so that's full time. Look on the bright side, everyone. At least it's over. Opening night of the Gallagher Premiership here on Harlequins Live, supported by Silverbug. Didn't go as we expected it to, didn't go as we wanted it to. It's Harlequins 3, Exeter Chiefs 33. I think we've said pretty much all we can say on it, lads, but your final thoughts. Let's try and scrape some positives from what's a pretty torrid scoreline, starting with you, Aaron.
Yeah, tricky, definitely a tricky one too. Like I said, probably 10 minutes ago before the scoreline really got a bit messy, I think we were there in terms of intent and physicality, which is obviously a minimum requirement for us, but in our accuracy, both with the ball and from a discipline standpoint, just has let us down. And you see them tries they scored, they are from penalties, essentially, all from line out 22 metres in our 22, and they're the best in Europe at doing that with their line out more and their pick and go attack. So yeah, chastening night, our boys will obviously be disappointed to start something we're really excited about like that, but yeah, onwards and upwards. We've got another big test in against Gloucester next week, and I'm sure we'll be up for it.
Must be super important now, you know, you'll all be back in the training ground, back doing the video sessions, and all the lads will be around. Really important to remember why you were excited yesterday and why you were looking forward to the season ahead. I mean, it's one game, it's one win, it's one bad result. Nobody is going to play Premiership rugby this season and not lose a game and not have a bad day, right?
No, exactly. And I think, like, what is most important is how we bounce back from this performance. And
well, how do we bounce back then?
Well, you know, like, I'm sure the coaches and our leader player will, like, analyze all the aspects of the game on the Monday and, you know, go through solutions. And I just think, like, this group is really willing to work hard and achieve something. So, like, obviously it wasn't our night, but I think we need to take credit of our first 60 minutes, which was, as Aaron said, a lot for a lot of intent. And physicality, and, you know, just adjust the area that was obviously wasn't good enough this game, and bring it to next week.
Lots of work on one. What's the saying? One swan doth not a summer make. It's something like that. One bad performance, it's not the end of the world. Quins will be back. Did I get that
it's
right?
A swallow, isn't it?
Swallow. What
one
did I
swallow
say?
Swallow does not make a summer.
Did I say swan?
Yeah, I think so.
A story for another show. I hate swans. Everyone loves swans. I've got real beef with swans. But anyway, Ricky, great to see you. Thank you for your company. Thank you as well, Aaron. Good luck on the road to recovery. Looking forward to seeing you both back in the quarters. I'm going to head to the pitch side now to try and get an interview. I've been told to bring the mic with me, but it's got a cable in it, so we'll work something out. But stick with us. The players are just going through the tunnel. These guys are going to go and... well, maybe try and cheer up some lads. But thank you very much, boys. Stick with us. I'll be back shortly with some player interviews. Hopefully, being able to find a wireless mic. Is there one somewhere? Oh, just unplug it. All right. See you in a couple of minutes, guys. Plenty to talk about, and I'm sure the things that they'll want to talk about, they'll want to keep amongst themselves as well. Well, Steph still on the touchline now, just taking a drink. I wonder if he might come over and say a quick hello. He's probably got some BT Sport commitments as well. Just a reminder that this is Harlequins Live, presented by Silverbug. We are doing the live watch-along and the build-up show for every home game this season in the Gallagher Premiership and in the Heineken Champions Cup as well. Plenty of opportunities for you, the fans, to get involved. Plenty of giveaways too. If you've just tuned in late, there is the chance for you to win that brand new third strip as well. The one that's made out of the recycled plastic, the For the Oceans initiative. All you've got to do is get on Facebook or YouTube, whatever you're watching this on right now, and let us know your rugby hero. Credit where credit's due out there on the pitch now. Sam Simmons is running over after doing his post-match duties. Of course, he got man of the match, a great hat-trick from him, typifying everything that Exeter Chiefs are about, grinding teams down, but also showing that little bit of magic as well. We'll give it another couple of minutes. If we're not going to get anyone, then I think we'll bring Rachel Burford in. She hasn't disappeared just yet. I wonder how many of those team talks she's had to have over the years. Do you think we're going to get someone, Russell, or do you think we'll... We were promised somebody. All right. In which case, have you still got your microphone with you, Berth?
I do.
You do. In which case, step in here. You've got a smile on your face, but you're just about the only person with a Harlequins playing contract who does this evening. That was quite a tough 80 minutes for the boys.
Yeah, I think, you know, look at 70 minutes of the game. Yeah. Really good. Like, you can see the detail that's gone into training and the amount of hard work that the boys have put in. They've come out and they've shown progression, they've shown improvement, and it was just that last 10 minutes where they literally let in three tries in that last 10 minutes, so it doesn't give a true reflection. I think their effort was outstanding, the work rate, the kick chase. I mean, they were literally sprinting off the line, you know, trying to get their rewards, and it was just, you know, little margins in it, you know, 50-50 decisions, penalties. And like I said earlier, if you're gonna play against a side that are the best in the world, in Europe and in England at the moment, the danger zones is in your 22. And too many times conceding penalties, they're going to kick to that corner, pick and goes, driving lineouts. You know, so they'll be really disappointed, obviously. But I think they will reflect on that 70 minutes and be happy with some of the stuff that they put in there.
Do you think you need a little bit of time to assess that, though? Because I'm sure if you walked into the change room now and said, concentrate on the 70 minutes, we probably wouldn't be able to broadcast the words that would come back in the general direction. But in a couple of days' time, when they review it, do you think they will be able to take the positives from the first half and then the first half an hour of that second half?
Yeah, absolutely. I think they'll all be thinking, wait a minute, it was 3-12 for the majority of that game. How did we let that get away? How did we let it slip? So they'll be doing a lot of internal judgment, and they'll be only focusing on that last 10-15 minutes. And that's how you are as a player. You forget about the really good stuff a lot of the time, and you focus on the things that haven't gone right and haven't gone out or haven't gone to plan like you hoped they would. And so I think, you know, they'll have a rest day tomorrow, come in on Monday, eyes on, you know, unit split. We'll look at the backs detail, look at the forward detail, and, you know, the whole coaching team will be looking at it thoroughly and, you know, rebuilding for next week. They can't you know, focus on it too much, because, you know, it's a quick turnaround. 5-6 days later, they're back out here on the pitch, and they're going to want to try and put some wrongs right.
And I spoke about this with Mickey and Aaron up there. You can never look at a great performance or a bad performance as anything other than one performance. There's not going to be a team in this league this year that goes undefeated, that's going to play to their maximum potential every week. You've just got to dust yourself off and think we've got another 20 or 30 games this season.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, you're only as good as the game you've just played. So they'll be focusing on it and trying to learn from it, but just moving straight on. And, you know, if it was the other way around tonight, you know, they'd be really chuffed. But again, they'll be reviewing it, looking where they can get better and focusing on the next game. Because that's how you got. It's a long league, it's a long season, lots of games to be played. And like you say, you know, teams aren't going to be on the up the whole time. You know, you do have dips in performance and individuals, people coming in, coming out again. So, you know, there's still plenty, so much to play for. You can't base your season on the first game.
We've got to give credit where it's due. Exeter Chiefs, they're Premiership champions, they're European champions. And for long periods of that game, they didn't look to be doing a lot, yet they're leaving here with a bonus point win, and they've got this season. They haven't conceded a try, and they've got this season off to the perfect start.
Yeah, I think, you know, like in the first sort of
40 to 50 minutes, they were going side to side and they had no real option of where to go. Harlequin's defence was relentless. You know, they got their spacings really wide. They were coming up, staying really high, putting them under a lot of pressure. But then, you know, it was that discipline in that later end of that second half that then allowed them to pin them down into the bottom corner, get their driving line out on, pick and goes. I mean, it's one of the hardest places to defend anyway on your line with a strong pack, with somebody like Sam Simmons, who, I mean, oh my God, he was unbelievable tonight. But if you allow teams in that area, you're going to get punished for it. And, you know, they'll be disappointed that they gave them those opportunities to get those late three tries.
Sam Simmons was unbelievable. I said with the lads earlier, there were two number eights on the pitch tonight. I'm astonished that they haven't got more England caps between them. It just shows the strength and depth of Red Rose at the moment.
Absolutely. I'm with you on that. His first try, Sam Simmons, oh my God, you know, back would be happy with that sort of try and that gas to get on the outside. I mean, it was no easy finish for him, but really impressive. And yeah, same with Don Brandt. I mean, showing different skills at number eight, you know, a couple of good kicks. I know I joked, want to see him carry a bit more, but they weren't, you know, bad kicks. No. They were into space, turning the pressure on the opposition. You know, really unfortunate for the crossing. Could have been a try, could have looked a lot different. But yeah, both of them, you know, Domers has been on the radar for a long time now, and every time he gets a bit of a knockback that he hasn't been capped yet, he steps up and he performs really well in a Quinn's shirt.
Sorry, I'm not. I've just seen you. We've got Scotty Baldwin coming over, going to grab a chat with him. Won't keep you for long, Scott. Can we just have a quick chat on that microphone there? Tough one this evening. You've been building up to something, a lot of excitement around this one, and when you look at the scoreboard, that's not what you'd have wanted when you kicked off tonight.
No, all week we spoke about discipline, we spoke about not letting them get into our 22 because we know how lethal they are all time. For first half we were really clinical defensively, we kept on the back foot, an error off set piece and they score. Second half we come out, we were try disallowed, which, look, that happens. Was it a try, was it not? And we were in it for 60 minutes, but then the last 20 minutes, as I spoke about discipline, we conceded 17 penalties to 6.
That's what it was. Cool.
And look, they had three chances. There's no surprise they're the best team in Europe. They can see, they convert when they get into the 22, and that's exactly what happened today.
Looking at that then, the penalty counts and the fact that they didn't have a lot of opportunities, they just capitalised on the ones that they did have, does that make it an easier fix moving into the next round?
Yeah, I think it's an easy fix, but we just need to be better. It's the simple things. Discipline is all on you. It's nothing to do with the opposition. It's about ourselves, and we need to be more clinical there. We need to get out, roll away quicker, probably leave the ball a bit because we weren't getting the rub of the green. We probably needed to identify that earlier and just leave it because our defence structurally was really good. But as I said, it's the more really. We just need to work on a more defence because that's what killed us tonight.
I really appreciate you coming back out because you've all gone straight back into the changing room. I'm not going to ask you what was said in there, but what's the general atmosphere? How is everybody feeling?
Frustrated because, as I said, we've lost the game on everything we spoke about not doing this week. So the positive is we get another chance next week to put it right. And as you said, they're all fixable. We know what let us down tonight and we can fix it. It's just going to be probably a bit of a tough week in training this week to rev it up.
Do you know, when you mention next week then, your eyes change. Do you look like you're really up for this season? Are you optimistic? Are you excited about what you and this group can do on the pitch this year?
Yeah, definitely. In the off-season, we asked for a lot more detail in the way we play, and we've got that. So it's down to us now as players, and that's exciting. It's frustrating tonight, but it's exciting. We know 60 minutes against the European and the Premiership champions, we were in the fight. It's just, as we said, the mould defence and the discipline, which are easy fixes. I say easy fixes, they're fixable. So, next week's exciting.
Well, thank you very much, Scott. Appreciate you coming back out and looking forward to seeing where you go with it.
Thank you.
Well, he's pretty much reiterated exactly what you said there. They know what the fixes are. It's just a case of whether they can do them. But, and I don't know if you could see that over my shoulder, when he talked about next week, his eyes lit up. He's up for the fight.
Yeah, I think they probably all want to get back out there tomorrow and try and right some wrongs. Yeah, you know, just to re-echo what he said, they came out with a clear game plan and talked about the simple things, getting the basics right, and at times that let themselves down. But hopefully he'll continue and the rest of the team will look at that 60 minutes and take confidence from that 60 minutes and turn it into an 80 minutes game. Because there was lots of brilliant moments, a lot of times we were in their 22, on their try line, and then, you know, one bit of discipline or one loose ball and then we're back on our 22. So there's plenty for Guzzy and the team to take away from that and to learn from. And then, you know, let's look ahead. There's no point dwelling and sitting and thinking about this game. All you can do is learn from it.
Tiny margins. Now, I've just been told that we have a winner for the shirt. However, they've texted me on my phone that I've left up there. So the winner is... You've just handed me your phone that's got about 20 text messages on it.
I know, that's Crystal Sean.
Right, the ham radio junkie on YouTube, a daughter's rugby hero, is Hugo Monier, awesome on the pitch, and always made a point to say hi to her at the end of each match, and gave her a signed big game shirt when he retired. Well, another shirt to add to that collection is this one, so congratulations. Thank you all for entering. How cool is that? We've given away the brand new shirt. They haven't even worn it in the game yet. It was only released yesterday. You were wearing one in a swimming pool. So congratulations and thank you all for entering. Thank you for joining us as well. We'll be back with Harlequins live on the 20th for the Heineken's Champions Cup game. And we'll be back. I've been saying the whole time it's Gloucester Hartbury, but you've got Gloucester Hartbury next week. We've got Bristol Bears. That'll be the next game. So I'll be on the microphone for that one, and hopefully Berth will be out on the pitch tearing it up as usual. And then Quins will be marching into the Saracens game, top of the league once more. Thank you for tonight. We've had a good time, haven't we?
Yeah, we have. We've had a good time being back, live sport, back at the Stoop. That's what we love. Yeah. Just want a little bit different on that scoreboard.
Next time, thanks to Berth, thanks to all of the players who've joined us. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for all the guests that we spoke to in the pre-show. This has been the first Harlequins Live of the season. We look forward to you joining us next time. But until then, goodbye. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Stoop as Gallagher Premiership Rugby...
But this is our home, and we are ready. We've trained to be harder, faster, stronger.